Utah's tightest in-state rivalry features the Aggies and the Cougars. BYU leads at 33-32-3, but it wasn't always so. The Aggies once had the Cougars' number until one of their own defected to the South. Since former USU letterman Lavelle Edwards took the BYU helm, the Cougars have won 16 of the last 21, including a current streak of 10 in a row. The prodigal son returns to Logan, Utah as BYU battles Utah State next on KJAZZ 14. From your vantage point at home, it's a gorgeous day here in Cache Valley. From our vantage point, well, it's a little bit chilly, but we're having fun anyway. It's a kind of a family reunion, so to speak. One of the Aggies' own left the fold, formed a team of his own, bringing him back, and he's going to try to beat up on his alma mater. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome aboard. I'm Carlton Wing, along with Craig Hislop. Now, this has the makings, historically speaking, of a great game.
I'll never forget the day. It was October 18th, 1980. It was projected to be an offensive show here in this stadium. Jim McMahon for BYU, Bob Galliano for Utah State. These two guys are still in the NFL playing today. What happened was BYU got a 64-24 lead after about three quarters. They took McMahon out, brought in a guy named Bryce Higbee or something like that. He quarterbacked for a while. The Aggies went 22-6 in the scoring. They brought back McMahon. Final score, 70-46. I think it could be that way today because the defenses are a little down for both teams.
And both defenses are looking for some leadership today.
That's right. Jermaine Younger, of course, is the leader of the Utah State defense. He's been healthy most of the year and playing well. On the other side of it, BYU has had some people step up. Corey Cook, a defensive back, has played very well lately, but they're without Todd Herget, they're without Hall, they're without Ted Dawson. Their linebackers are depleted, their defensive backs have struggled, so they're in a little bit of trouble.
Could be an exciting game and a historical affair. We'll be back with the kickoff right after this.
With the arrival of autumn, KBYU invites you to take the plunge. Fall into celebrated children's educational programs. Fall into coverage of exciting BYU football and basketball. Fall into an impressive lineup of classic movies, travel, adventure, and news programs. Above all, fall into the kind of quality programming that allows you to feel comfortable every time you turn on your television. As a KBYU viewer, you know the programming on Utah's Family Station is worth supporting. And fall is the perfect time to show your support for these outstanding programs by making a donation to Utah's Family Station. Send your donation to KBYU TV, 2000 Ironton Boulevard, Provo, Utah, 84606. So take the plunge. Fall into family viewing with KBYU.
Back live at Romney Stadium in Logan, Utah, the Aggies have just made their thunderous entrance into the stadium here. 34 degrees is the game time temperature, and we'll get to a high of about 50 before the afternoon's over. Take a look at the series. BYU just one game ahead. Might be surprising to some.
But they've won the last 10 to pull ahead, as they have, and it's been their series. They've won 16 of the last 18. It's interesting, Lavelle Edwards, as the head coach, lost his first three games against his alma mater and has been 16-2 since then. And let me say one thing to redeem myself. I said on our little pregame cut a moment ago, the quarterback in that memorable 1980 game was Bryce Higbee. Bryce Higbee's a redshirt or a walk-on quarterback at Utah State from American Fork. Royce Bybee was the guy I was talking about that filled in for McMahon. So, sorry, Royce.
There we go. Reading, it's a little cold out there. Getting set for the kickoff. Joe Herrick out to kick for the Cougars, and back to as deep as James Dye for Utah State. The fans have been rather anxious getting into this game, and there's the kick, and we're underway here in Logan. And it does roll out of bounds, and we open up with a penalty. That might not be a good sign for things to come.
Utah State, Carlton, decided when they won the toss to start the game to receive the ball. And I know that you talked to Lavelle Edwards about their strategy, and he thought he was kind of leaning toward deferring to the second half.
That's always been his philosophy.
Bounds. Ball replaced on the 35-yard line.
Weatherby
first
says,
down.
We want to be more aggressive. We want the ball now and get going on offense.
In fact, Lavelle said that when the rule was first instated that he had the choice for the first 3 years, that's what he chose all the time.
And then lately, he's been a little bit more philosophical about it. I asked him if he had the confidence in his defense to put them on the field first, and he said he did. As it ended up, he's doing so anyway. First and 10, balls at the 35. Calvillo looks and finds Tony Jenkins, a gain of about 5 yards on the play. Vic Tarleton and Jack DeMooney with the tackle.
I was watching to see how the BYU defensive front would play it, and any stunting this time. They will use that a little bit, not a lot. They didn't that time. They pretty well played that straight, and Calvillo had a good time on a short drop.
And there are a lot of holes in the BYU defense. We're talking about some injuries, and we'll get into that as the game progresses. Second down, 5 yards to go. Kevin Alexander in the game. Kind of a long cadence. They give to Profell Greer up the middle. Gets about a yard. Swarmed by Greg Pitts, big number 99. He's out of Provo. Played at Tempe High School.
Pitts is being blocked by number 57 for Utah State, Jason Maughan. And the Aggies' interior defensive blockers showed a little bit of a pass block look that time. And then the handoff went right up the middle for about a yard.
There are quite a few changes on defense as both Todd Hergett and Nathan Hall are out to the linebacking position, creating some last-minute scurrying by the coaching staff. Third down, 4 yards to go. Ball is at the 41-yard line. Calvillo back, looking and goes to the big man, Aubrey Thompson. He gets the first down yardage about the 47-yard line before he is knocked out of bounds. Done so by John Pollock, defensive back for BYU.
Nice pressure coming from the left side of the BYU defensive front. Andrew Nash, it appeared, was the guy in there that time.
First and 10. Aggies knocking on the door of Cougar territory here as they get set to cross midfield. Fake to Greer. Calvillo gunning downfield and just throws it away. There was nobody within about 15 yards of that pass.
Toward the end of that pass route, number 81 for Utah State, Cody McMahon seemed to be showing a little bit of hesitation and sort of gave up on the pass, and maybe that's because he knew he was covered well enough that Calvillo would have to throw it away.
Anthony Calvillo, as you take a look at his numbers, 8 interceptions on the year, 9 touchdowns. He's thrown quite a bit, over 2,000 yards so far in this season, and he is 6th in the nation in total offense. Brings up second down, 10 yards to go. Also on the 47-yard line, 2 men wide to the right. That's Cody McMahon and Mike Lee. And Calvillo has the ball knocked loose and falls on it at the 41-yard line. That was Randy Brock.
Yeah. Brock coming in from the left side, the big junior out of Rexburg, Idaho. And Jim Zorn told us this week, the Aggie offensive coordinator, he really likes the play of Brock and Gomes, but even more so Brock. And there was some pressure there by Randy Brock.
Brock leads the team in quarterback hurries. He's got 7 so far on the year, and that was a key hurry right there, forcing the fumble and making Calvillo fall on it. Brings up third down, 15 to go. Ball's back at the 42-yard line. Whistles are blowing, and Calvillo takes a soft hit. And a little bit of excitement there. Randy Brock involved.
Well, Jed DeVries, number 75, and Jason Maughan, 57, the two senior tackles, want to make sure their quarterback is protected even after the play is over. And they didn't like that little extra activity there.
Penalty looks to be a delay of game.
On the offense.
That's the call. Move them back another 5 yards.
Last year against BYU, Calvillo threw for 266 yards. Aggies pretty well moved the ball up and down the field last year. He threw 57 passes, but because the running game wasn't working, which is the story every year it seems like for the Aggies against BYU, Utah State never crossed the goal line that 3 field goals.
Third down and 20. Calvillo needs a long pass and guns it, finds Tony Jenkins up the middle. He gets to the 37-yard line in BYU territory. He's tackled by Patrick Mitchell and Corey Cook. A big pass play keeps the drive alive and puts them into Cougar territory.
As a rule, now BYU will play what we call bracketing defense with the two DBs on a wide receiver. The Aggies were expecting Jenkins to be double-teamed a lot. Here's Calvillo dropping back, looking to his left. Jenkins is coming back from the sideline over the middle and makes the catch. And again, he was bracketed between two defensive backs, and Calvillo found it for a nice gain.
Profell Greer in the backfield. Mike Lee and McMahon up to the top, and nothing doing. In fact, a loss of about a yard. That's Gomes and Matt Redden, who is filling in at defensive end today as Travis Hall has moved to the linebacking position, filling in one of the gaps there.
They've made a lot of shifts with Todd Herget out. There's Jenkins, who made the catch a moment ago. Todd Herget's gone. Nathan Hall's gone. Ted Dawson got hurt this week with a stinger in practice. He's out. They've moved Hall to the place where Dawson would have been, and Redden's now at Hall's spot at defensive end.
Coach Edwards is impressed with Travis Hall's speed, and that's why he was able to move him back to the linebacking core. That's complete to Thompson. And dragging him down is Jack DeMooney, number three. The junior out of Hawaii. He was a dancer at the Polynesian Culture Center down in Hawaii.
Well, he was step for step that time.
That's a nice
Here's
play.
The replay. A little bit of pressure from Travis Hall, so Calvillo gets rid of it quickly to Aubrey Thompson. DeMooney's right there. A littler defensive back, not as heavy as Thompson, but doing a nice job.
Brings up third down, 6 yards to go. Ball's on the 33-yard line of BYU. Three men wide to the right. For Utah State, and Calvillo goes to the left and finds Thompson again. Had one man to beat there, gets close to first down yardage. Again, it was DeMooney with the stop.
Well, that time, Shane Yearbrook pretty much came right up the middle. Now, he's one of the linebackers. He plays the middle linebacker. Here's a freshman out of Norco, California, and he made Calvillo get rid of that ball in a hurry. Here's Anthony, and you may see Yearbrook coming just there. He is 46, but he got it off to Thompson just in time.
They'll bring in the chains to mark this one from all the way across the field. There's a look at Aubrey, 6'3", 230 pounds. 29 receptions on the year. Last year, he led all the Big West tight ends in both receptions and touchdowns. He's got two touchdowns so far this year.
With the way BYU is approaching this game defensively, the Aggies were expecting Aubrey Thompson to have a lot of one-on-one opportunities against the linebackers, and that's happened, and they've gone to him two or three times already.
And he did plunge ahead for the first down yardage. That you might have heard the crowd erupt behind us. So it's first and 10, ball's on the 27-yard line. Calvillo gets back to the huddle with the play.
He's already, Aubrey does, already have more catches in this game than he did last year against BYU in the 30-9 loss.
McMahon, and that's Lee at the top of your screen, and Greer in the backfield. To give to Greer up the middle, he runs into traffic and dropped the ball.
BYU's got it.
That was Greg Pitts evidently recovering the fumble there. That's his first fumble recovery of the season. And it stops what had been a pretty successful drive for Utah State.
Well, now, I hate to bring this up so early in the game, but this is a lot of what happened last year against BYU. The Aggies had upwards of 400 yards of total offense, but never got across the goal line. They had to go with the field goals by Sean Jones for their points.
Now, this will be our first look at John Walsh. Had a coming out party last week. We'll talk about that as he gives to Willis around the right side and is tripped up. Tripped up by number 18, Tyrone Trimble.
Trimble was a standout last week against UNLV. He was Charlie Weatherby's guest at all the media gatherings this week, and he may have another trip or two to Salt Lake if he keeps up with that. He was coming on strong from that far side, made a nice stop on Willis.
The second leading tackler here on this Utah State team. It's kind of deceptive, though, because he's got, that was his 45th tackle of the season. Jermaine Younger leads the team with 81. Second down, 14 yards to go on the 4-yard loss by Willis. Walsh barking out some orders to his left side. Give to Willis again, this time around the left side. He's got a little bit of a gap and gets back a couple of yards. Oh, there's a fumble. And it's Utah State ball. Pratt Lyons in on the fumble causing. Knocks the ball loose. Utah State gets the ball right back about where they lost it from. caught us all off guard.
Here's the play now. Willis is going. Watch 51. Younger's going to come in the picture here in just a minute, trailing the play. Willis runs into the defensive back, Toomer. I think the ball squirts loose. Lyons jumps on it. There's Younger. This is what happened against UCLA. They wanted to establish a running game early. Willis fumbled early, and the next 17 BYU plays were passing plays. They've got to establish the running game, but you can't when you're fumbling the ball.
Mike Lee at the top of your screen. Looks and finds Aubrey again. Gets about 2 yards out of it. He's tackled by Travis Hall. There's a look at Aubrey, and they seem to be establishing him in the early goings of this game as one of the go-to men. Boy, just barely got that jersey with his right hand. That's something that will elude you by the time the game ends and fatigue starts to set in. Those grips on those jerseys aren't as tight. Second down, 7 yards to go. Calvillo looking again, gunning, and overthrows his intended receiver. That was Mike Lee. Frank Christensen on coverage there. There's again, a flag on the play.
Lee is the guy who comes into this game with numbers almost identical to Dredge for BYU. The same number of catches. I think they're tied for sixth in the nation, but Dredge has a lot more yards.
Dredge is the big play guy for BYU, and there is no flag. I don't know if you can see it on about the 19-yard line. There's a hot spot there. Looks like a flag. We'll have to avoid that for the rest of the game. Third down, 7 yards to go. Ball's on the 22-yard line. That's Greer in motion to the bottom of your screen. Coverage by Randy Brock over, and there's Aubrey Thompson, drops it. Just turned around. That was Pollock again with coverage for BYU.
Well, Aubrey was behind the coverage. The pass was not a pinpoint one, and he had to turn around, and it's hard to keep your hands stationary and grab the ball at the same time. Calvillo dropping back, a little pressure from the outside from Brock again, and Steve Thompson has to turn to face Calvillo, and that's tough to hold onto the ball in that situation.
Brings up a field goal try here. This would be about a 40-yarder, which would match Nate Morreale's long of the season.
That was against Baylor. Todd Wilson holding.
Kick is up, and it's good. The Aggies draw first blood here as they put the first couple of points on the board. The Aggies 3, BYU 0 here in the early going. Still in the first quarter. Back in a moment, right after this. Back in Logan, Utah. Utah State has jumped on the board first with a field goal, a 40-yard attempt by Nate Morreale. And they're set to kick off now. That's Micah Knorr doing the kicking for Utah State. A high kick at about the 10-yard line. And a punishing blow at about the 21.
That was Johnny Williams, who's a backup linebacker for Utah State, a special teams player mostly, rarely plays on scrimmage downs.
And stop Steve Christensen, as we'll take another look here.
Watch this at about the 21 or 2-yard line. Wow. Number 49, Williams, coming in to make the stop.
And he's the number eight in the NCAA in kickoff returns. He averages nearly 28 yards a return. First and 10, ball's at the 21-and-a-half-yard line, we'll say.
Now let's see what the BYU attitude is again with the rushing game this time.
It's complete to Christensen at about the 25-yard line, a pickup of about 4 on the play. Damon Smith brought him down.
A little bit of pressure from the outside from number 96, Scott Mawala, but the Aggies didn't have anything fancy going on that time, just the straight rush.
There's a look at the scoring drive, just 4 plays there.
And the key play, actually, was the fact that Willis fumbled the ball and gave it to him.
Couple of turnovers has turned into 3 points. Now the Aggies were driving before their turnover as well. Kind of a wash. Drage in motion to the bottom of your screen. Looks and finds Doman to the left side. He gets to the 36-yard line before he's brought down. Travis Scow with a stop. Utah State, that's a first down for BYU.
Aggies had a little bit of a twist going on with their defensive linemen, one going outside Lyons, one going inside Mawala, but it didn't help. No pressure on the inside, and Walsh gets the pass off, as you see.
Here's a look at Bryce Doman out of Salt Lake City. An older brother play for BYU.
Walsh seems to be changing the play, but again, it looks like they jumped the running game for a minute or two. They're throwing the ball.
Incomplete intended for Drage. That was where the confusion was. Damon Smith at the last minute dropped off coverage and then jumped right back on before the snap. Just a little bit over the head of Drage.
Again, Drage with 49 catches, the same amount of catches as Mike Lee for Utah State, but he averages nearly 17 yards a catch, which is a bunch. Lee with 49 catches averages 10 yards a catch. So you can see how productive Drage is for BYU.
Second down, 10 yards to go. Ball's on the 36-yard line of BYU. That's John Walsh out of the shotgun. Trying to elude. That's Dave Balls. And it's complete to Tim Nowotzki. Nowotzki down to about the 38-yard line of Utah State as the Cougars now move into Aggie territory.
Well, that was a great play by Nowotzki to dive. I thought he might have been out of bounds, but he was all stretched out. Here you see Walsh out of the shotgun, and he looks to the left. He's flushed out a little bit under the pressure from Ball. So on the run, he throws 30 or 40 yards downfield. And here's the stretch, and we didn't see him actually catch it, but he was in bounds. It's a good call by the official.
Look at Tim Nowotzki, caught his first touchdown pass about 30 miles from his home in near Notre Dame, Michigan City, Indiana. First and 10, ball's on the 38-yard line to give to Willis. Willis gets to about the 35-yard line, tackled by number 21, Michael Coe.
At this point, Carlton, Utah State defensively is playing it absolutely straight. Maybe a twist or two with the defensive lineman, but nobody's blitzing right now. Here's a little bit of a draw play out of the shotgun, and Willis gets a little bit of running room. That play started 38, so he got to 3 yards.
Got to try to keep Willis from getting a speed. He was the first Cougar rusher to go for over 1,000 yards in 20 years last year. He just eclipsed the 1,000-yard mark in the last game. Second down, 7 yards to go. Walsh out of the shotgun again. It's batted down and up for grabs. And number 22 intercepts it. That's Donald Toomer, his second interception of the year. As he falls down on about the 30-yard line.
I don't know who tipped it in the middle. It could have been Pratt Lyons. It could have been Danielle Taplin, number 96. Here's Walsh dropping back. Pressure from the outside. Might have been Mawala or Taplin when he threw it, actually. It was hard to tell, but there you see Toomer coming up with it. The leader in the Big West in interceptions last year. Another look at it. Walsh, well, there's an interior man. I think it might have even been Balls now that I look at it again, slapping it up in the air.
Well, we've seen more turnovers in the first about 7 minutes of this game than I thought we'd see, but 6 minutes, 49 seconds left here in the first quarter. That's Greer moving up close to the line, first and 10. Wide open was Greer, and he dropped the ball. A little bit high, but got both hands on it. That was catchable.
Well, he had 9 catches coming into the game, so he's been through this before.
Ophel Greer is one of the exciting surprises here for Utah State this season.
Let's give a little credit where credit's due now. David Balls officially gets credit for the deflection on the pass and the play that led to the interception.
Give the Greer around the left side. Got a little bit of room using that speed. Only gets about 2 yards. Mitchell and DeMooney with a stop for BYU.
I was watching Carlton Calvillo on that play, and I remember talking to Jim Zorn, the offensive coordinator this week for Utah State, and he said the last couple of games going into UNLV, Anthony had been watching the game. And I said, what does that mean? He said, well, he would hand off to a running back and watch the play develop. His job is to carry out his play because if he still got the ball. This game, he's done that a couple of times. He did it on that play, although it didn't mean anything to Greer because it didn't work. So those things pay off maybe a little later on.
And it's kind of hard not to want to watch Greer when he gets the ball. He's been that exciting, 209 yards last week against UNLV. Calvillo looking and overthrows Tony Jenkins. Jenkins was about 2 yards past the first down marker, but it does bring up a fourth down. Calvillo's missed the last 4 attempts. Pass. Kind of in a funk right now, as you say. Well, back to punt, Mike Anore. He is averaging just over 35 yards a punt. And receiving for BYU is Eric Drage. Dangerous receiver, dangerous returner. Graves moving back, a nice punt. Called one of those short fair catches. Almost like he could get away with it if he didn't want to.
That was that is the many games I've seen. I haven't seen all Utah State's games, but that's as good a punt as Norris had this year, I believe. It's put BYU in fairly poor field position. A nice, high, coverable punt.
We're going to take a break right now with 5 minutes, 54 seconds left in the first quarter. Score is still Aggies 3, BYU 0. You're watching Aggie football on KJAZ 14.
Tanzania's Serengeti Plains, home to all kinds of wildlife, like these infant cheetah cubs. But the plains are also home to bigger cats. And that means home sweet home can be a dangerous place for cheetahs in the land of lions. Will they survive? Find out next time on Nature.
Watch it Tuesday at 8 and Saturday at 6.
We're back in Logan, Utah. BYU set to take over, first and 10 on their own 18-yard line. Look at John Walsh.
You mentioned during the break about the turnovers, and we've had two or three already. Walsh had not thrown an interception the last two games until this game today.
That was his sixth on the year. That's Willis up the middle, gain of about two. Brought down by Dave Balls, big number 91. Out of Ogden, Utah, played his high school ball at Bonneville High School.
See, at some point, BYU knows they've got to make the Aggies respect somewhat their running game to suck them in on those runs and then create some openings for Walsh.
That was one of the keys that Lavelle talked about last evening, was he's been trying to run the ball all season long. And if he can, feels like if he can open his running game up, he can be successful today. Second down, 8 yards to go. Walsh out of the shotgun. Looking and firing to Doman, who trips himself up on about the 26-yard line. And pick up about 5 or 6 yards.
It was Doman on the play coming from the outside. This is Walsh dropping back. And again, it looked like with the extra defensive backs that Utah State's got in there, that Walsh finds Doman after a little bit of pressure. Now you see Doman going down the field, and then he cuts across this way. They carried one deep back out with the pattern that way and created an opening over the middle for Doman.
And we've got a timeout on the field as BYU calls timeout. They saw something they didn't like. It was third and three, balls on the 25-yard line. Let's look at the cool Aggie faithful. Cold Aggie faithful. 3-0. Back in a moment right after this. Minutes, 39 seconds left in the first quarter. Aggies 3-0 over BYU as they approach the line facing a third and three situation. Ball's on the 25-yard line. That's Drage in motion to the bottom of your screen. Complete to Doman, whose knee hit the ground. The official says the knee hit the ground. No more yards after that point. It looks to be about half a yard to a yard shy of first down yardage. Now, one of the new faces that we're seeing in the backfield, you'll see Chad Knowles, number 21. He is filling in for Kalen Hall. We understand Kalen is injured. Here's a look at the play again. Let's see if we can see the knee hit.
Right as he catches it, really, as Michael Cole comes over, number 21, to make the stop, and they're going to measure to see if where the knee went down was enough for the first down.
That's close, and it looks to be...
couldn't be any closer than that.
Yeah. Well, they don't get much closer than that. That's one of those times when you wonder if that's exactly where the knee hit, or 2 inches above or 2 inches behind. Brings up fourth down, and you saw how long to go. Again, Kalen Hall, we have early reports did not stress out before the game today. And so that further decimates what's kind of a beleaguered BYU team here. With they enter in with just Jamal Willis as a regular starter. We'll see Steve Christensen, number 25, and number 21, Chad Knowles, rotating in and out.
Well, here you've got a guy, Willis, 520 yards as a freshman, 1,090 as a sophomore. You know he's good. He's just been hurt most of the years. Case with Hall as well.
Big play in the drive, going for it. Fourth and one. That's Chad Lewis in motion to the top of the screen, and there up the middle, and for first down yardage is Jamal Willis.
Just a simple little dive play, and that's exactly what they needed. And I'll tell you, the people on the left side there, probably Edwards and Empey, and those people on the left side of the offensive line cleared a wide hole. Somebody tripped Willis up, but he had plenty of room for the first down.
And a nice diversionary tactic there. Chad Lewis, number 96, moved up to the other side. Willis has 6 yards so far in the early going. Not much for numbers of runs that he's had. It's about 6 attempts. First and 10, ball's on the 30-yard line. There's Willis around the right side, and he is trapped up. The ball is loose. The ball is loose. It looked like it was Jermaine Younger in there creating the contact.
They cleared a path for Willis, although the Aggies were congesting it, but he had a little bit of room, and then with time, here comes Younger, and I think he did knife in there, maybe get a fist in that thing and knock it away, and a BYU offensive lineman jumped on it.
And they're falling on the ball. Second down, 13 yards to go. Ball's on the 27-yard line. Walsh out of the shotgun. Checking off receivers, and he's got a man open deep. And Willis with a one-hand grab. Gets it to the 10-yard line. He'll score. Touchdown, BYU. What an amazing catch by Jamal Willis. It looked to be overthrown, and Willis batted it with one hand and caught it with the other.
There's
72
Walsh.
Yards on the play. Look at that catch.
We get a chance to look at that from the end zone camera.
And what a punishing hit there, as Jermaine Younger was actually gaining ground on Jamal Willis. That's Younger, the linebacker. Take a look at Willis there, 220 pounds, 6'3", out of Las Vegas, Nevada. And that's going to be on the highlight reels for a little while to come. Joe Herrick on for the extra point. Just over 3 minutes left here in the first quarter.
He just came right out of the backfield and was one-on-one with a linebacker. We might get a look at that after the break, possibly.
And the kick is good. BYU jumps out to a lead 7-3 here with just over 3 minutes left. As Herrick is 26th PAT on the year. He's only missed three. Lots to celebrate here in the early going for BYU. Let's see if we can get a look at that play again. There it is.
There you see Willis. He just cleared out of the backfield, and there he is in a foot race with Jermaine Younger. He juggled the ball for a minute, but by then he was out front. Look at Younger get wiped out by a block across the field. A big play. We were talking to Dick Bumpus, the defensive coordinator for the Aggies. He said, it's been our history this year. We'll stop somebody for 15 plays, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the big play, and it beats us.
We'll go back to several games and pinpoint a couple of those. Steve Christensen, he was the guy that laid down that block that took Younger out of the rest of that play. Let's look at the scoring drive. 82 yards, 72-yard touchdown pass from Walsh to Willis. That's Walsh's 17th touchdown pass of the season. We're set for the kickoff again. Deep for the Aggies. That's number 6, James Dye. He averages nearly 20 yards a return. Dye takes it at the goal line, and he'll continue on. Shooting a little gap there if he can keep his balance. Ends up falling backwards at about the 25-yard line. Nice return.
Interesting thing with the Aggie special teams is that Dye, you can see, obviously, very quick and speedy, but when he's been out or been hurt and unable to return kicks, Tony Jenkins, the veteran wide receiver, comes in. He's returned 9 of them for almost 25 yards of return. He's 21st in the nation.
There's a look at James Dye, 5'9", 155 out of Oakland, California. Calvillo going deep. He's got McMahon open. McMahon about the 22-yard line. Tackled by number 10, Vic Carlton. And the Aggies strike right back. It's about a 52-yarder right there.
Here's the end zone shot of it. They're clearing it back over the middle and coming long down the sideline. We can't see him right now. There in the picture is McMahon making the catch, and he's on his way. again, this is starting to unfold like that game we talked about in 1980, where both teams had all those yards, Galliano and McMahon in a battle.
I don't think either one of these teams have the letter D in their title, Utah State or BYU. 53-yard reception, as you saw, for McMahon. The give to James Dye, looking for some room, changes directions, comes around to the right side, and gets into about the 18-yard line. Tackled by number 90, Lenny Gomes for BYU.
Dye was not available last week to the Aggies, and that's opened the door, in fact, the last couple of weeks for two outstanding games for Greer. Here you see James to the left, changing directions back this way, gets away from Pitts there and starts around the end, dodges another Cougar, and then two more are there to make the stop inside the 20.
Pickup of about five on the play. Brings up second down, 5 yards to go. Calvillo rolling to his left. Looks back across the field and finds Aubrey Thompson. He can outrun Lenny Gomes. He might have a touchdown. And he does. Touchdown, Aubrey Thompson.
This is an 18-yard touchdown pass on a tight end screen. The tight end is right there. We'll see that in just a moment. This is Thompson. I don't know if you'll see him in the picture when Calvillo starts back this way, but he's going to set up blocking, and now he's out of our picture. Calvillo now turns, and he's going to fire down to his tight end. The screen is set up, and Thompson's on his way at the 20, and he goes on in there with a block is Jed DeVries.
And on through the extra point here with just inside of 2 minutes left in the first quarter. We've already got some points on the board. The kick is up and it's good. Aggies retake the lead 10-7 here in the early going. That was Thompson, his fifth catch of the day. He's already got 38 yards and a touchdown here in the early going. The fans are up in the nosebleed section, but they're happy. Happy Aggies. Well, BYU traditionally allows a few points in the first quarter, but that's not really that much different.
This is Aubrey Thompson, who came to Utah State as a wide receiver, and he has that kind of speed. He's added some bulk to become a tight end, and you see him powering himself into the end zone after that toss screen all the way across the field by Calvillo. Well-conceived play, and it really had BYU's defense strung out.
Came from all the way across the country to play ball here. He's from Atlanta, Georgia. Well, so far the fans are getting what they thought they would, and that's some scoring as we take a look at the drive here. 75 yards in just three plays. The big 53-yarder to Cody McMahon, and then capped off with the 18-yard touchdown reception to Aubrey Thompson, the tight end. Tim Nowatzki and Tyler Anderson deep for BYU to receive the kick. Tyler Anderson, a speedy one. He averages 26.6 yards a return. He takes it on the 2-yard line. And he just got that speed and pushed it right on up to the 25-yard line before he's knocked down.
Shandell Smoot, who's a special teams player, number 38, and number 31, Sean Coleman, combined simultaneously to finally make the stop. That was a nice coverage play by the Aggies.
Entering BYU's huddle there. There's number 25, Steve Christensen. Number 88, the tight end, Terrence Salioni, coming in. Both quarterbacks have already thrown for 121 yards here in the early going. And Walsh out of the shotgun, possibly looking for a little bit more. Give to Willis. Shoots a little gap and moves ahead about 8 yards to the 33-yard line before he's tackled by Michael Coe and Tyrone Trimble from Utah State. BYU has not abandoned its running game yet.
Well, and the way it's looked on a couple of plays, they shouldn't. I think maybe Simmons and Pilgrim and Herring on that right side cleared out the backup defensive tackle, Matt Hawk, quite nicely, and that allowed Willis some extra yards.
Got about a minute and 18 seconds left here in the early going. 2 men in motion, both to the left side. Walsh barking out some orders. Then to the play of the scrimmage. That's Jermaine Younger beckoning for the crowd to raise its volume. Walsh just gets the ball away and throws it out of bounds.
Now that time from the outside, Matt Hawk, who just got beat on the last play. There's Charlie Weatherby. He's not very happy about something. Hawk came with pressure from the outside and forced Walsh to hurry the throw to the sideline and out of bounds. Charlie's really upset, obviously.
Seems like every time the opposing quarterback in an away stadium starts barking out some audible signals, that's the signal for the fans to really lift up their voices. And that's what Younger was trying to get the fans to do here.
I think Weatherby was pleading that BYU committed offensive pass interference on that play.
Either way, third down, 2 yards to go. Ball's on the 33-yard line. Single setback is Willis. And the give to Willis. And he is met and met hard by number 91, Dave Balls. Dropped for a loss. Dave Balls found the penetration and put the end to the Cougar drive. Well, lost a couple on the play.
Now, Dave Balls is not a big guy at about 250 pounds. There you see shedding a block from either Pilgrim or Herring, and they're huge guys in comparison to him. He did a nice job to shed the block and make the stop and force the punt.
This is a look at Alan Boardman, number 8, the punter for BYU. He's number 8 in the nation in punting. 43, nearly 44 yards a punt.
Well, James Dye is 16th in the nation in punt return, so we got a pretty good match here, and it's a low punt.
I will probably let this roll out of bounds, and he does, about the 27-yard line. That was a quick offensive outing for BYU, what they term three and out. We've got 18 seconds left here in the first quarter. Utah State takes the field here, and there's Wicked. The Aggie mascot. Look at Lavelle Edwards, the son returning to look at Utah. Calvillo looking and going deep up the middle to Mike Lee and underthrows him. Just threw it right a little bit low and behind him. It's called low and outside. Patrick Mitchell with coverage, as well as Corey Cook was around there as well.
Lee was the slot man to the left. He was set inside of the Jenkins. Here's Calvillo going to the closest of the receivers. Jenkins is cleared to the outside apparently. And there's Lee on the tail end of it. And again, he was bracketed. One guy behind him, one guy in front of him.
It could have been taped at the last moment as well. Second down, 10 yards to go. 12 seconds left in the first quarter. McMahon down on the left side. Lee at the top of your screen. Calvillo dropping back deep and throws midsize over to Mike Lee. He gets about the 39-yard line. First down, brought down by Jack DeMooney, number 3.
That time, the wide man was Alexander. He just sprinted for the end zone. Lee cuts down and over the middle. Calvillo's waiting for him to break off his pattern, and there he is. And he's hit immediately, but again, another catch and some good yardage, and that's the end of the quarter.
11-yard reception there to end the quarter, and we will take a break as the Aggies have moved out in front of BYU. 10-7 here in the early going. Back in a moment, right after this.
They gave us the banquet, the toga, the Keystone Arch, water conduits, and Roman numerals. They were the Etruscans. Now you have a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see their treasures direct from the Vatican Museums to Brigham Young University's new Museum of Art. Premier exhibit October 18th through April 30th. For tickets and information, call 378-BYU1.
We're back. The beginning of the second quarter. Utah State jumps out to a 10-7 lead. We'll take a look at one of the reasons why. Anthony Calvillo having a good day here early, 9 of 15, over 130 yards already, and a touchdown pass. He's got the ball first and 10 just inside the 40-yard line. That's to give to, hit hard with James Dye. That was a punishing blow. I'm not sure who got there first, was it Randy Brock or Corey Cook? They both end in 7.
Again, the slot receiver, Mike Lee, was in this particular play serving as a blocker, trying to get a block on the outside as Dye starts to the outside. There's Davies, the left tackle, trying to clear the way, but he really had no blockers where he was going that time.
Let's look at Corey Cook. He's really come on in the last couple of games for BYU. Again, the give to Dye. He's got some room. creates some room with his speed, gets out to the 48-yard line, tackled by number 56, Travis Hall. Bring up a third and about 2 yards to go.
Ryan Davies is playing left tackle now for the veteran Jason Maughan. Trying to see if they've got any other second unit people in there, and he seems to be the only one right now. Just the only adjustment they made on the offensive line so far today.
Again, James Dye in the backfield. That's Mike Lee and then Tony Jenkins. Wide receiver to the left side. Dye moves up to the top of the screen. Third down, 2 yards to go. Calvillo quick out to Mike Lee. He's got first down yardage and trying to create a little more. Squirms ahead to about the 42-yard line. Tackled again by Mitchell and Cook.
This time again, leaves the slot man. The wide people are McMahon and Jenkins. They're just heading downfield to clear out that flat for Mike Lee. And again, that gets him a little one-on-one as Calvillo's looking for him all the way. The shorter pass as the wide receivers have headed down the field to give Lee some room. And now the DBs come up and make the stop.
Brings up first and 10. Ball's on the 43-yard line in Cougar territory. Again, James Dye, the single setback. Three wide to the right side. Give to Dye. He moves around to the right side and unable to find any room. Randy Brock got there first. Greg Pitts was helping out. For BYU, Randy Brock. He was a freshman All-America his first year with BYU.
Well, actually, on the football news, he was a sophomore All-American, and they picked an all-sophomore team. So he's well-regarded nationally.
Mentioned before at Rexburg, Idaho, he was the defensive player of the year there at Madison High School. Second down, 11 yards to go, about a 1 yard loss on that last play. Again, that's Dye in the backfield. Calvillo fakes to Dye and going up the middle and aiming for Cody McMahon. He was being well covered his entire trip down, and that was Corey Cook covering him.
Nothing fancy about that, Carl. It was McMahon there on your screen just sprinting for the post. And they were looking for him all the way. And Calvillo really airs this one out, but the coverage was good. Cook was right there.
Looked like there could have been a deflection as the ball left Calvillo's hands. The ball did look a little bit like a wounded duck in the air. Third down, 11 yards to go. Ball still on the 44-yard line. Calvillo's got some room up the middle. He's going to take it. He'll get the first down yardage and a little bit more as he gets to the 26-yard line. There's some of the versatility of Calvillo paying off for the Aggies.
Well, here's one for you. The Aggies last year, of course, moved the ball quite well but didn't score touchdowns. Here's Calvillo. Calvillo, as you watch him run against BYU, is the only guy returning on the Utah State team that carried the ball on a rushing play in last year's game. Everybody else is gone. And he is not a bad running quarterback, as you can tell.
17 yards on that play. Puts him first down. 10 yards to go. Ball's on the 26-yard line. And a tight end. We've got number 86, Xavier Foreman. James Dye on the counter play. Looking for some room and just can't elude the grasp of number 56, Travis Hall. Lenny Gomes in on the play as well.
Well, that wasn't Rich Tilski's fault. He took Randy Brock completely out of that play. Tilski is the Aggie guard, the senior from San Diego. This is a veteran offensive line that Utah State throws against BYU today. But these are not new guys on the other side of the line with Gomes and Brock and Travis Hall's played a lot, and Greg Pitts, too.
Second down, 8 yards to go. That's Pofel Greer in the backfield, and the ball's batted away at the line of scrimmage. Harmlessly incomplete. Lenny Gomes got the big paw on it there.
McMahon was his man. He was the guy he was, the Calvillo was throwing to out on the flat to the right side. A medium route and a short drop, and Anthony couldn't get it there because of the deflection by Gomes.
Lenny, the two-year letterman in Santa Rosa, California. 11 minutes, 31 seconds left here in the first half. Third down, 8 yards to go. Ball's on the 24-yard line. Calvillo back and looking deep. He's going for Mike Lee. Incomplete. The ball drops loose. Lee looks a little upset, but he's not arguing too heavily. That was Frank Christensen with coverage.
As is always the case now, Lee is the slot man, and The wide guy was Jenkins on the play. At the sideline, he cut down and toward the goal line, and Lee went down and out. And that you saw the end of the play, and the ball is out of bounds. There's Calvillo thrown to the sideline. Lee's running toward the end zone at this point. And there's the end of the play, and didn't have control of it, apparently, before it went out of bounds.
Ball was right there. Now, this will be the longest attempt, or if it's good, it'll be the longest kick of Nate Morreale's career here this year, and it is. It's about a 41, maybe 42-yard field goal for Nathan Morreale. Freshman out of Irvine, California, as he takes Utah State up to a 6-point lead, 13-7. Back in a moment, right after this. We're back in Logan. Utah State has jumped out 13-7 over their in-state rivals, BYU.
Carlton, let's take another look from the end zone at that play. Aggies are maintaining that might have been a touchdown at the end of it. Here's Lee catching it. A foot is down. He seems to be controlling it until he hits the ground. And once the ball crosses the goal line, they've told me that if you're in control, it's an automatic touchdown. Now, he dropped it later as he fell out of bounds.
Very interesting. We'll see how that will come back to haunt. In the meantime, the ball died in the end zone for a touchback. Cougars take over first and 10. So look at the scoring drive there. Morreale with a 42-yard field goal. That's his longest of the year.
Remember the key run by Calvillo that gave him a first down, and two nice catches by Lee earlier than that.
Again, John Walsh out of the shotgun. Next to him is Jamal Willis. He throws and it's almost intercepted. Jermaine Younger had it right in both hands. Threw it right when he was most vulnerable in the numbers. He'll be seeing that one in his sleep tonight.
Well, it was Dredge in a tight slot and a short drop by Walsh, and that meant that Dredge was covered one-on-one by the linebacker Younger. And Jermaine blew a real opportunity to return a pass here. Dredge in the short route, and there's Jermaine making what he thought was a catch, but he couldn't. So he got kind of handcuffed on it, what he did.
He had an interception last week. There's a look at Jermaine. He was right up there for Big West Player of the Year. We've got some movement on the line here. Whistles and flags everywhere. Just like a parade. Every official with a flag threw one.
On the offense.
False start.
Still
call.
Second down.
The Cougars back another 5 yards. Second and 15. Just look at Coach Weatherby. He was really enthusiastic coming into this game. When the team was entering the field, he was giving high fives and cheering the team on. Second down 15. Walsh out of the shotgun. Looks and finds Eric Drage. Picks up right at about 15 yards. He might be, looks like where the lineman's going to score it.
Dredge is a little slow getting up, Carlton. He's whipped his helmet off, and he might be hurt. Donald Toomer and Younger there combined. Let's look at it again as Walsh takes the snap in the shotgun. He was looking maybe a little deeper, but he goes to Dredge at about the 20, and then Gary Brown's closing in, but it's Younger and Toomer that actually combine on the stop. They hit him pretty hard.
It's pretty punishing. There's his first catch of the game. He's 15-yarder, a nice 15-yarder. He's the career record holder at BYU, both in yards. He's got just over 3,000 with 3,024. He's sixth in the NCAA in receptions a game. He's getting 7 catches a game. And he's also got the BYU touchdown record.
Well, the Aggie goal defensively here was to not let him get away. In other words, he's going to get his catches. Let's keep him to a minimum yardage-wise because he's a big yardage guy. The other thing was to try to slow down the run. It was a two-pronged defensive plan for the Aggies.
We'll take a break right now. Just under 11 minutes left here in the first half. Utah State out in front, 13-7. Back in a moment right after this.
Great Performances and American Playhouse team up for the first time to bring you the first ever television production of a towering musical theater classic. Join us on Catfish Row for the Gershwins, Porgy and Bess.
Watch it Saturday at 8.
10 minutes, 59 seconds. We're going to take a look at that hit right here. And you see the head just get knocked from one side to the other. The crowd you hear behind us is cheering as Dre just walking off. He's being assisted, and I was going to do it on his own. But that was a blow. That's we don't know. It could be a shoulder. It could be what they call a stinger, where it's kind of a whiplash motion, generally from the side to side. It kind of does a little bit of a nerve strain there.
Yeah, from the angle that Younger came in, it could very well be a shoulder nerve type thing. That is, those stingers you've been talking about have really sort of felled the BYU defense with Hergett and now Ted Dawson this week in practice. There's another look at it here.
Well, the clock is ticking again, and Walsh plunges ahead for the first down yardage. He'll take it himself, gets about a yard on the play, brings up first and 10 as they get to the 31-yard line. Let's look at Walsh's numbers early on, 135 yards. Impressive. If you take last week's stats when he came in 2 minutes before the end of the half, if you prorated those stats out through the course of an entire game, he had 900 yards and 10 touchdown passes against Fresno State last week.
Well, I've never seen anything like it. I saw him come in with 2 minutes left in the half and saw some amazing stuff the rest of the game.
Impressive display of the talent there. He fakes to Willis and throws up the middle to a wide open Terrence Salioni. He gets to midfield, falls forward to about the 49-yard line, tackled by both Damon Smith and Michael Coe.
Now, the Cougars have been using a lot of two tight ends, and I'm not sure if this time that was the case. Salioni is the tight end, and he starts out right here. And then the defensive back, in this case, I think it's, in fact, he got by the linebacker, and Brown is cleared right out of the play. Brown, the linebacker, went this way. Salioni's going this way and makes the catch. But Brown got lost because it went with a wideout to the other side of the field.
Ends up being a 20-yard gain for Salioni. Provo, Utah. Walsh back to pass again. Looks and finds Chad Knowles, but Knowles lets it go right behind him. I think he heard footsteps on that one. That was Damon Smith with the big loud beat that time. Chad Knowles is a sophomore. He's out of Sandy, Utah. Played his high school ball at Alta High School.
This is Walsh dropping back again. Has some time, as he's had a lot today, really. And a nice blow delivered immediately there by Damon Smith, number five.
Second down, 10 yards to go. Walsh again out of the shotgun. Knowles and Willis next to him, providing pass blocking coverage. And right up the middle for a gain of about 7 yards. Again, complete to the tight end, Salioni.
That was one of those times where it appeared that the Aggies were bringing both linebackers. Now, I just mentioned Gary Brown. He's starting today in place of Bobby Singer, as heard. Brown's been on the shelf a little bit this year, but he and Younger are the inside linebackers, and it looked like they were both coming on watch on that play.
Third down, 4 yards to go. And the crowd really encouraging the Utah State defense to hold them on this drive up the middle, and nothing doing. No game. Pratt Lyons, that ball was loose. Pratt Lyons fell on the ball, and it's a turnover. Utah State takes over. With his second of the game and a big turnover, coming at a big time in the game here for Utah State.
Well, Toomer had the interception, and now Lyons' second fumble recovery. It was more like a steal, really. I didn't see the ball pop out, but in any event, Utah State's defense has stopped the Cougars and gets it back with a little over 9 minutes left in the half.
BYU will look back at the first half stats and see those three turnovers, and that is what has allowed Utah State to get into this game and get the lead going. First and 10, ball's at the 42-yard line. Calvillo back looking and firing deep. He's going for Kevin Alexander. Double covered, and that was actually ended up being closer to number 17, Corey Cook.
Again, Mitchell and Cook bracketing number four, Alexander, who is on a dead sprint to the end zone. Here's Calvillo, and they're not thinking about anything else other than going long to one of the speediest guys on the team, number four, but the coverage is there. Well done that time by the Cougars.
Mitchell and Cook with coverage. Now, Kevin Alexander is not slow by any means. He's a sprint champion out of California, 100-meter sprint champ in high school. Calvillo was 4 out of the last 13 attempts. Rear up the middle, gain of about 3, stopped by Travis Hall. And there's a late flag. take a look and see what happened there. Greer looked to be involved.
Nice block in the play by Utah State's number 79, Ernie Howron.
Close to a late hit. I think that might have been what Greer was a little upset about, as he tackled the guy who tackled him.
Yeah, he and Travis Hall got into it there a little bit.
They do call the penalty on Greer. That's a 15-yard personal foul. Some scores in Salt Lake City. Utah 7, San Diego State 7. That's a second quarter score. Henry Lusk had an interception in the end zone, stopping the San Diego State drive. Got just over 9 minutes left here, just under now, 9 minutes left here in the first half of our game. Early in the second quarter, Notre Dame and Navy are tied up at 10 each. Third down, 23 yards to go. Ball is on the 30-yard line. Utah State.
Thompson is set out wide to the right as a wideout, not a tight end.
They end up with four receivers on the left side, and they go to the right side. And that's Thompson. He just eludes some tacklers. And finally brought down by Lenny Gomes. He just muscled through those guys.
Well, that's a special play set up for this game by the Aggies. They've got three wide receivers to the left, and their tight end is flexed to the right, and Calvillo's going to him all the way. Here's Thompson coming back along the line of scrimmage and makes the catch, and he's off to the races. He's the featured receiver today for the Aggies.
They have gone to him frequently, and they've been successful doing it. However, they weren't as successful as they wanted to be. It's fourth down, 13. Ball's on the 40, and we'll bring in Micah Knorr to punt for the Aggies. And the ball takes a Cougar bounce. The Aggies are trying to fall on it somewhere, and it gets to the 40-yard line.
That time, BYU had Matsuzaki back as the punt return man. They've used Dredge, who's out of the game right now, and Mike Johnston a little bit in those positions.
7 minutes, 48 seconds left here in the first half. You're watching Aggie football on KJAZ 14. Back in Logan, Utah, Utah State still hanging on to a six-point lead. Carlton Wing here along with Craig Hislop. John Walsh, the ball is loose. Walsh trying to, it's still loose, and Salioni finally falls on it. That's a huge loss of about 12 yards on the play. Ball was loose, misdirection on the handoff, trying to get the ball to Willis.
Well, he and Scott Mawala went for it at the same time, and they got there at about the same time, and that made it squirt away, and that allowed Salioni to get on it. This is kind of a casual handoff here, really. Willis didn't turn around very quickly. I guess he thought he had the ball.
You don't want to go head-to-head with guys like Mawala either when you're diving for a loose ball. All right, brings up second down, 21 yards to go. Again, Walsh being chased out. Hit all over, he's lucky to hang on the ball there. It was Pratt Lyons providing the most pressure there on Mr. Walsh, who's having a rough time the last two plays.
Of all the wonderful things this guy does as a quarterback, he is not very mobile, and you see it right here. The Aggies pressure him, and finally, he can't escape. Jim Sweeney calls it the escapability factor, and Walsh, who's a great thrower, will probably improve on that over his career. He's not real good at it right now, trying to get away from a rush.
That weakness probably was really highlighted at UCLA when he was sacked 10 times, and overall, Cougars were sacked 12 times that game. The blitzing backs from UCLA hurt them, and that's what Utah State hopes to capitalize on today. Out of the gun. Walsh throwing deep and wide open is number 25, Christensen, who takes a punishing blow and stops him from the first down. That was Michael Coe. A key hit stops him about 1 yard shy of the first down marker. Had he not hit him the way he did, he would have fallen forward and gotten the first down.
It's interesting to watch the BYU passing game. Most of the time, they're running a lot of diagonal routes and stretching the field from sideline to sideline. They went right down the field that time, which is more or less the way the Aggies like to attack it on the passing mode. They're going to measure here after that great play at the end of the catch to see if he got the first down, and he did.
They moved the mark up a little bit. Michael Cole, you saw him on the screen there a little bit ago. He's second team All Big West. Very impressive open field tackle there. First and 10, ball is just shy of midfield, on the BYU side of midfield. We've got just 6 minutes and counting left here in the first half. Walsh again out of the shotgun. Movement on the line, whistles blowing. There's a flag, there's another.
Thought I saw the tight end Chad Lewis moving. He's number 96. He was set to the right of that formation.
False start on the offense.
False start. Now BYU has already been penalized 67 times coming into this game. Nearly 650 yards they've lost. There's a look.
Well, that was bad artwork that time, but it's the center that moved. I was trying to circle the center in this picture here. Also, the right tackle moves a little bit. I think I'm a little bit off on my positioning of my telestrator. You get the idea.
I'm gonna check your grades in art class.
It was Ron Simmons.
There's Walsh looking and fine. Well, he underthrew that one by a margin, and the flags were flying again. Oh, and BYU goes back to the locker room at halftime. They're going to look at the turnovers, and they're going to look at the penalties here. It's just stopping these drives and really making it very, very difficult for BYU to drive the ball down the field.
Holding.
There's a look. It was holding.
10 yards.
It's a major back to the 30-yard line. So Cougars are going in the wrong direction to get a first down. They are going to have to get to Utah State's 40-yard line. And we've seen this before against Utah State. On the lower right of your screen, see if you can see that. Possibly the right guard grabbing hold of one of the Aggie rushers. I think it was Balls that was tied up by the right guard, Evan Pilgrim, on that play.
Big play here. First down, 28 yards to go. Walsh is trying to look deep but can't find anybody deep. And then looks like he does find. No, he's being waved off. The ball did hit the ground. Incomplete pass. He was trying to find Chad Lewis, the tight end.
Well, there's Walsh's throw. It's low. Lewis can't get to it. And immediately the Aggie sideline, about 55 referees on the sideline all calling it off.
And we do have an injury report for Eric Drage. He has broken a rib. That has got to be a big loss for BYU. They do have lots of offensive weapons to choose from, but Eric Drage was that leader there with the receiving core.
Well, on top of the defensive injuries they've had, they've been really hurt now.
Second down, 28 to go, following the incomplete pass. Again, out of the shotgun. Walsh looks and finds Tyler Anderson. Now, if he can break loose, he is fast. He gets to the 45-yard line, 5 yards short of the first down. Tyrone Trimble finally brings him down. That's a big gain there for the Cougars.
He was the wide man to the left, and they had, I think, Nowatzki to the right. He just looked in, and a quick toss by Walsh. There's Anderson.
Anderson got a 25-yard gain on that play. Brings up third and five, and that's a little bit more manageable than the field position the Cougs were having to deal with a little while ago.
On the replay there, you see quite a cushion provided by the Aggie defensive backs. Anderson, who is very fast, had plenty of room to run.
Yeah, it looks like if he had another stride or two, he could have broken it wide open. Third down, 5 yards to go. Crowd getting into it again. More movement, more flags, more whistles. More players just kind of standing around trying to figure out what's going on. Another penalty.
Dead ball. False start.
Official
looks offense,
almost tired.
5 yard penalty. Third down.
Brings up third down, 10 yards to go.
Well, the right tackle, the left guard, the left tackle. Actually, only Simmons and Pilgrim stayed put. Everybody else was moving on the play. Somebody didn't get the right signal.
Brings up third and 10. Penalties are putting the Cougars in precarious positions here in the early going. Walsh looking deep, trying to find Matsuzaki, and he does. He can break it. He gets stumbled and drops down at about the 2.5-yard line. That was Travis Scow with a shoestring tackle just to throw off a little bit of balance of Matsuzaki. Needless to say, big first down play.
Well, he's the wide man to the left. They had a wide out to the right. I think they took Christensen out of the backfield, although we don't see him, because it looks like Walsh is going to the wide, the long man, the deep man all the way. Well done between Toomer and Scow.
Big 47-yard completion.
There is Scow. To the right of your screen, we can't see the wide receiver just yet. But there's Matsuzaki at the end of the play.
261 yards passing in the early going here for John Walsh. He pitches back to Jamal Willis, trying to find an opening. He's got one.
goes in on a post, touchdown BYU.
Well, he dodged an oncoming Michael Coe, number 21, in a nice athletic move to create himself more time and more room for the touchdown.
Well, that seems to follow the script. Let's take a look at the play here.
Here he steps right inside of Coe, then back to the outside as the blocking developed for him. Well, that was a nicely conceived one, and it looks like most people did their jobs on the blocks.
We take a look at Joe Herrick here getting ready to kick the extra point attempt. Nowatzki holding. The kick is up and good. And it's good. BYU takes a one-point lead with 4 minutes, just over 4 minutes left here in the first half. Flags are waving proudly. BYU 14, Utah State 13. Back in a moment right after this. Back in Logan, Utah, BYU jumps back, takes the lead by 1 point here with just over 4 minutes left in the first half. James Dye back deep for Utah State to receive the kick from Joe Herrick. Kick is up, held up a little by wind. Dye takes it about the 5 yard line. He's got an opening and it closed up by the time he got there. About the 22 yard line is where he is dropped. Again, that was John Pollock with the stop for BYU. Take a look at the scoring drive there. Willis, 3 yard touchdown rush. That is his fourth touchdown of the season.
And again, a key play, the big pass to Matsuzaki down that sideline in front of the Aggie bench was the one that kept that one going to BYU.
Kind of follows the script of Utah State. They'll stop him and stop him and stop him and then give up the big play and keep that drive alive. 3 minutes, 59 seconds left. First and 10, ball at the 22 yard line. Calvillo looked like he tried to hand it off and was unable to do so, trying to work as many yards as he can out of it, and he'll probably get about 2 or 3 feet. Lenny Gomes chasing down the quarterback. Looked like he was ready to hand the ball off when the running back was about 2 yards ahead.
Cougars really did a good job stringing that one out to the sideline, and after the initial confusion on the handoff or expected handoff.
Second down, 8 yards to go. In the backfield, that's Dye, and they give to Dye around the right side. He's being pursued well. That's Randy Brock in and chasing him down to the other sideline. Also, John Pollock in on that, number 27 of BYU. 3 minutes, 9 seconds and counting. Look at James Dye. That's about a 2 yard average there. Six rushes, 12 yards.
Dye's best game this year was the 112 yards he had against Fresno State, but that was two or three games ago, and he missed last week because he was injured.
In the backfield now is the Big West Offensive Player of the Week, the reigning Player of the Week. That's Profel Greer, as Calvillo finds some pressure and eludes it. And he plunges ahead for first down yardage. What a courageous dive there at the end. He had two players diving for him. It's oftentimes when people can get injured.
He was literally in what the NFL calls in the grasp. Travis Hall, who's playing linebacker and defensive end, depending on what situation, comes in here from the left 56. You see him, and then he collides with his own man, and Calvillo has a chance to take off after that collision wipes out both the Cougars.
Makes the first down yardage. 2 minutes, 25 seconds left in the first half. First and 10, ball's on the 34-yard line. Calvillo back looking over the middle, and Mike Lee just simply let that ball go past him.
As it turns out, Carlton, Utah State's running game right now is Anthony Calvillo on these plays that he creates after he can't get rid of the ball on passes. I think he's got 26 yards to lead the Aggies in rushing right now.
Second down, 10 yards to go. There's a look at Charlie Weatherby, 7-11 here in his second year at Utah State.
The 30 points that his team allowed BYU last year is the fewest in the series in this 10-game streak that BYU's got going.
Calvillo back and firing again to Lee. This time he does get a hand on it, but is unable to control the ball. And it falls loose, incomplete pass, brings up third and 10.
This is Lee. Now, again, two wideouts are headed downfield, so he's man on man, but the ball is not where it's completely catchable. We've seen one-handed catches this year. Seemed like most of them were made by Nevada Reno against the Aggies, but wasn't in the books that time, as both, I think, Alexander and Jenkins had headed downfield to give Lee the one-on-one opportunity.
Willis picked up one of those one-hand snags for BYU on the other side of the ball. Third down, 10 yards to go. Calvillo back, flushed out of the pocket. Kevin Alexander complete for first down yardage. 48-yard line before he's knocked down. Jack DeMooney with a stop. They move it up to the 49-yard line, counting as forward progress. It's a 15-yard pass from Calvillo to Alexander. Kevin also has a twin brother playing on the other side of the ball, Corey Alexander.
Watch the replay. DeMooney and Mitchell there close. Patrick Mitchell ready to back up. But again, they had bracketed the wideout Alexander on that one.
First and 10, inside of 2 minutes. They give to Greer around the left side. Squirms his way and finds about 7 yards out of that. That's nice second, third, and fourth efforts there by Profel Greer. DeMooney and Brock finally tackling. Second down, 3 yards to go. Looks like we've got a timeout on the play. Utah State takes a timeout. Profel Greer coming off that 209-yard rushing performance at UNLV last week.
Well, actually, Profel, the week before that, here had 115 yards in that battle for Nevada, with Nevada, for basically what a lot of people think will be the conference championship. And the last couple of weeks, he's run well, over 300 yards, and actually 6 touchdowns the last 2 games.
In fact, in one of those games, he had the opportunity to tie the record for most touchdowns in a game. He had 4. Gave the ball to him 3 times in a row at the 4-yard line and was unable to do so.
That's a record held by Jack Hill, who BYU fans and Utah State fans alike will remember from the late 50s. Jack went on to play for the Denver Broncos for a while. He was a great running back at Utah State.
I understand in Salt Lake City, of course, still 7-7 in the second quarter. Utah missed a 33-yard field goal. So they've got a tight one there as well. And we've got a tight one here. Not too surprising that the game is this close. The traditional rivalry, at least here in the last 10 years, would dictate that it would be a blowout by this point, but not so. BYU is coming in, has come in stumbling a little bit. There's a look at Coach Edwards there. 195 wins. He needs one more, and he'll tie. Hurry up, Yost, for the next spot on the most wins list. There's Calvillo, flushed out of the pocket, and no one is close. It looked like the intended receiver, Mike Lee, cut inside when he was supposed to cut outside. Greg Pitts providing coverage on Calvillo.
That's, again, that formation that they call trips open, where they've got 3 wide receivers to the right, and they have taken the tight end, especially for this game, Aubrey Thompson, and set him all alone as a flexed receiver to the left, and then go to the 3 wideouts that time. And they've been going to Aubrey earlier in the game.
McMahon, Alexander, and Lee are all on the top of your screen. The right side, he finds Mike Lee. He's got first down yardage, gets to the 35, working his way for some more, and gets to about the 25-yard line before he's knocked out of bounds. Extra effort there got him about another 8 or 9 yards, 19-yard pass play.
And again, McMahon and Alexander cleared downfield, and Lee's got room. It's Pollock that finally takes a shot at him and misses, and then he's run out of bounds over there by Vic Tarleton.
First and 10, balls at the 25-yard line. 1 minute, 15 seconds left in the half. Calvillo back, looking. Again, flushed out of the pocket, eludes the tacklers, moves ahead. He's got about 8 or 9 yards out of that play. Gee whiz, who needs running backs if you've got Calvillo? You see the clock winding its way down.
Obviously, nobody opened. Calvillo looked and looked and had some time, and then goes into the dimension of his game that BYU may not have going right now for them, and that is the ability to scramble and run, and he continues to be their leading rusher today in this game.
And Utah State takes another timeout. We've got 48 seconds left here in the first half as BYU defense is coming to the sidelines to talk it over. We'll take a break as well. Aggie still down by 1 point with 48 seconds left in the first half. Back in a moment right after this. 48 seconds left here in the first half. Utah State down by a point.
Aggies have been doing something today that they've done fairly well all year. They're converting on third down. They are 8 of 12 on third down conversions. BYU is 3 of 6.
Calvillo asking for some quiet so he can bark out his orders. He's facing a second down and 1 yard to go. Greer gets that yard and a little bit more. Knocked down at about the 10-yard line. First and 10. Randy Brock finally tackles him.
Again, that formation spreading the field. The tight end wide to the left. The three receivers wide to the right. And it kind of stretches the wide defense just a little bit.
The clock held until they got the chains moved. And Calvillo downs the ball. A little bit extracurricular activity you saw there. Clock has stopped with 36 seconds on what is technically an incomplete pass from Anthony Calvillo.
Well, this is one of those situations where the Aggies want desperately to take a touchdown into the locker room. You never know how that will affect it. And this could be a wild second half for all we know offensively, but we remember what happened at LSU when they didn't convert going into the locker room, and it seemed to take something out of Utah State.
They went in down 16 to 10, and they just did not come back in the third quarter. Second down. 9 yards to the goal. Calvillo looking. He'll take a couple of them himself. Stops the clock by getting out of bounds. Lenny Gomes forced him there. About a 2 yard gain. The officials are calling time. It almost looks like a player has lost a contact or something. At least he's looking at the ground. Maybe he's just hurt.
Well, that
see
was
the top of your screen.
Yeah, that's Gomes over there who chased Calvillo out of bounds, and then they went rolling out onto the blacktop together. And that can be a little hard on your body, even if you do weigh 270 pounds.
The Brotherhood of College Football. 30 seconds left here in the first half.
BYU will bring in Scott Cirala at the nose guard position for Gomes. There's Gomes making the stop. Then he rolls out of bounds with Calvillo, lands on the blacktop, and has an as-yet-undisclosed injury. But he's left the game, and as I said, Cirala, the 270-pound junior from Kerrville, Texas, a highly recruited defensive lineman, is on the field for Gomes at nose guard.
Set to take the snap, third down. And goal at the 8-yard line. Calvillo. James Dye in the backfield. He moves in motion. Brings three wide receivers to the right side. Calvillo back and looking. Fires up the middle. Touchdown, Utah State. Mike Lee. Found the opening he was looking for. An 8-yard touchdown pass. Calvillo to Lee. As Lee grabs his third touchdown reception.
He was the tighter man in the slot and came across the middle. Everybody else in that formation went to the sideline, receivers anyway, and he was just one-on-one out there and beat Christensen to the ball.
And so that will affect the morale in a very positive way in the halftime locker room for Utah State. And they do get in there in the blue zone. The kick is up and good from Nate Morreale. So the Aggies jump out to a 6-point lead here with less than half a minute remaining in the first half. See the shot from our camera above the south end zone. Utah State 20, Brigham Young 14. And that was a nice drive for the Utah State offense, a morale building drive.
Aggies have now thrown for 194 yards in this game, 70 yards on the ground. BYU 261 yards throwing, but they're in arrears running the ball, a negative one. So I don't think you could say yet they've established their running game.
That's true. And they've been trying to stick with it. But negative one for a halftime stat on your rushing column is going to drastically affect your effectiveness on the passing column as well.
Although their most recent touchdown was a short Willis touchdown run to give them the 14-13 lead, but really the key play in that drive just previous to this Utah State scoring drive was the long pass to Matt Suzuki down the sideline in front of Utah State's student body.
set to kick it off, back deep for BYU, number 42, Tim Nowatzki, and in the close side of your screen, that's number 4, Tyler Anderson. Both of them very capable of breaking it open. They kick it on the ground. It'll be picked up and taken to about the 33-yard line.
Rob Morris, who's a backup running back and plays a lot on the special teams for BYU, and he fielded it after a little bit of trouble, but made a little gain out of it.
Well, John Walsh will come in with the 22-second drill here at the end of the half. Take a look at the scoring drive there. 14 plays on that drive. Capped off by that touchdown pass with 78 yards and ate up a little bit of time when they didn't have that much more to spare. John Walsh out of the shotgun, first and 10. Looks it back, looks and finds Micah Matsuzaki, gets to about the 39-yard line but does not get out of bounds. The clock will still roll until a timeout is called, which one is. It's Tyrone Trimble with a stop. Stops the clock with 13 seconds left here in the first half. About a 6-yard, 7-yard pickup. Matsuzaki was all everything in the state of Hawaii. As we take a look at the play again. Matsuzaki trying to get out of bounds at this point to stop the clock so they don't have to use the timeout. But Tyrone was all over him. Kept him from getting there. Matsuzaki's the 3-year letterman. He redshirted last year. The players call him Mouse. I'm not exactly sure why.
He's the wideout. Now, right there, he just stood his ground, made the catch, and then went to the sideline. His goal is to get out of bounds and keep the clock stopped. And when he didn't, they had to use a timeout. He took about 2 steps down the field, turned to face his quarterback, Walsh, and made the catch.
Both teams have 1 timeout remaining here in this half with 13 seconds left. Could come into play. Cougars approach the ball here. The ball's on the 39-yard line, their own 39-yard line, facing a 2nd-and-4 situation. Again, Walsh out of the shotgun. Looking and finds Jamal Willis, gets the first down yardage and steps out of bounds at about the 46-yard line. Stops the clock with 8 seconds remaining here in the first half.
Again, sending the receivers on sprints down the field and then clearing Willis out for the short play. That's about the only way you're going to eat up enough time to get even close. A stretched out pass down the field could have taken most of the time on that play.
Got 8 seconds left, and with the timeout feasibly, they possibly could get to within field goal range, but they might just have to go all the way for the end zone here. 1st and 10, ball's on the 47-yard line. Walsh again, looking, throws deep, and throws into coverage, intercepted by number 5, Damon Smith. Not that drive, in a hurry. With 1 second remaining in the first half, Damon Smith pulls down his 3rd interception of the season, and the 1st of this game. 2nd interception this game, I'm sorry. And Walsh now tallies 7 interceptions on the season. Take a look at the turnovers again, and just adding to the toll that the coaches are going to be addressing.
Well, you compute that with the fact that Dredge is out and the defense is already hobbling with the linebacker problems.
With 1 second remaining here, we'll see Utah State just put the knee down and go into the locker room with a 6-point lead. Utah State 20, BYU 14. That's the end of the first half.
Tanzania's Serengeti Plains, home to all kinds of wildlife, like these infant cheetah cubs. But the plains are also home to bigger cats. And that means home sweet home can be a dangerous place for cheetahs in the land of lions. Will they survive? Find out next time on Nature.
Watch it Tuesday at 8 and Saturday at 6.
Thank you. I've had a lot of great opportunities in my life as a professional athlete, but of all the titles and honors, the title that I claim and that means the most to me is that of being an American. That's why I'm honored to support the Freedoms Foundation at Valley Forge and to share with you one American's dream. I'm really just an ordinary guy that was born to an American family. I was raised in a home that believed in God and in a land that offered to me and everyone else I knew the opportunity to develop in mind, body, and spirit. My life, like millions of others, consisted of school, scouting, paper routes, McDonald's, making my bed, and Little League baseball. I was shy, happy, and secure. I thought the whole world was just as I was, a sweaty kid with a mom, dad, brothers, sisters, and a dog. I think it was in high school that I came to realize that there was something other than just my town and my own street. I became acutely aware that I was living during years of great history. Something began to stir inside of me, a feeling, a pride and gratitude for something I had always taken for granted, something very profound, a gift. My learning by then had expanded to the world, and I knew that in this nation, we had something unique. Just think of all we have witnessed during the 80s, the rise of Reagan and Bush, and the fall of the Berlin Wall. These were the years when heart transplants gave hope for extended life, yet AIDS began a death march. Abortion heated up, and fusion cooled down. Computers were found in every office, NutraSweet in every home. Disorder erupted in Panama. Hostages were captured in Lebanon, and war in the Persian Gulf made us aware of the need to be prepared. Bill Cosby made us laugh, E.T. made us love, and Ethiopia made us cry. I was living through years of invention, perfection, and growth, and so are you right now. I have come to understand something about the country we live in and the freedom we enjoy. I have come to realize that true freedom carries responsibility. As William Nelson states, self-government implies self-mastery. Private virtue, honesty, frugality, self-reliance, industry, and chastity can only result when there are choices between good and evil. And the people have the freedom to act and freely express their choices. Many of you express your freedom through the clothes you wear and the music that you listen to. Choices you make freely. Did you ever stop to think that the system of government we enjoy is a system which allows people to act according to their own moral agency? And with that freedom to act comes an accountability. Virtue is a primary responsibility of a people under this form of government. To require public virtue of the elected officials without private virtue in its citizens is to require something that cannot be. I believe the words of Benjamin Franklin when he said, "There never was yet a truly great man who was not at the same time truly virtuous." I came to understand that we are part of a very large world, but I also knew we are part of a very fortunate few that have been nurtured by freedom. Freedom, our instincts tell us we deserve it. To fulfill our desires, we need it. Lives have been sacrificed to defend it. Other nations have yearned and prayed for it, and we have so much of it. It takes freedom to pronounce that all men are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Destiny led me to become a professional athlete, but to be a quarterback in the NFL is not the American dream. The American dream is to pursue your own happiness. Happiness is not what some may believe. It has to do nothing with fame and fortune. Happiness lies in being truly free, free to choose what you will be, how you will live, and how you will spend your time. I like what Sam Levinson said. Freedom, he said, for me means the right to choose to be somewhat less than free, or not free at all, on behalf of some other equally precious human value, such as sacrifice or devotion, given freely for the good of some other person. The American dream is what a conductor does as he leads the choir. It's what a teacher does when she instructs a classroom of young minds. It's what a senator does when he represents the people who elected him. It's what my mother did as she patiently pushed, persuaded, and served her son. Each time I hear the national anthem prior to a football game or any sporting event, I experience feelings of emotion. As we remove our helmets in a moment of respect, I'm in awe that sometimes as many as 80,000 fans and athletes alike, with a feeling of oneness and devotion and reverence, stand in appreciation for all that the flag and our anthem represents. For a few minutes, we are all equally stirred with exactly the same feelings: respect, honor, and gratitude. Yes, my American dream is to have a family that believes in God and a land that offers the opportunity to develop mind, body, and spirit, where my children can grow up with a paper route, school, scouting, McDonald's, and Little League ball with brothers, sisters, and a dog. My dream is to be an American with faith in my Creator who endowed me with life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Next time on Nova, James Wren, magician and investigator of psychic phenomena.
Don't laugh, this is science.
Explore the world of the paranormal. Examine supernatural claims.
Jesus.
And journey with Randy to Russia to challenge their psychics. What is real and what is an illusion? Secrets of the psychics. That's next time on Nova.
Watch it Thursday at 8 and Saturday at 5.
We're just about set. We've got Lavelle Edwards. See him strolling onto the field here, beginning the second half. One of the other points that I think will be important here as we get closer to the fourth quarter is that Utah State's inability to nail the game shut. And that might go into several things. Charlie Weatherby, as enthusiastic as he is, tries to get these players as gunned up for this game as possible, but they have allowed 74 points here in the fourth quarter. And that could prove fatal if they allow another one of these games to slip away here in the late going, as they've established some early momentum.
Well, it used to be a problem the Aggies had. It showed up a little bit last year and at times this season, them coming out of the halftime locker room being a little bit flat. This is kind of a defining moment here for this football game, with the Aggies leading 20-14. BYU will take the second half kickoff.
You saw briefly there Tom Young warming up on the sidelines for BYU. Mike Anora kicks it off. Tyler Anderson back deep in the end zone. He will take it out. 2 yards deep in the end zone. He's got a little gap. And if he stays on his feet, he's a quick one. Gets out to about the 37-yard line. A very impressive return for Tyler Anderson of BYU to open up the second half of play.
The kicker, Mike Anore, made the stop on the play. And we started the game, or early in the game, with a big splatter shot on a kick by on the kickoff when a tackle was made by Johnny Williams. Williams missed it that time, and it was Noor that had to come on and make the stop for Utah State.
First and 10, ball's at the 37-yard line for BYU. Walsh again out of the shotgun. That's Jamal Willis next to him. And Jamal Willis gets the ball, and he's hit. That's Jermaine Younger. Tackle behind the line of scrimmage, about a 5-yard loss. Jermaine Younger with that quickness and penetration that Lavelle had talked about earlier being afraid of. Take a look at the play again. Willis with that nice open field stick. Make sure.
David Balls, a defensive tackle, really cluttered things up there as well. Nice play by him.
Second down, 14 yards to go. Walsh. That was Tyrone Trimble with the early coverage. The ball is loose. Looks like it was fallen on by a BYU lineman. See who comes up with it. That's number 70, Evan Pilgrim.
Either Mawala or Lyons forced the thing in the first place. So the Aggies are getting some pressure here at the outset of the second half. Out of the shotgun, Walsh comes. Trimble goes right by. A little pressure from Mawala, and I think it was Mawala that knocked it away, and BYU jumped back on it.
Well, BYU not opening up this half with impressive offensive numbers. They've gone backwards, 9 yards in the other direction, literally going south. A fake to Willis. Walsh rolling out to his left. Pressure from Taplin. goes down, and there's a flag on the play as well. Looks like Walsh is finding a little bit more pressure from the Utah State defense than he found last week against Fresno State. That brings up fourth and very long. We'll see what the flag is.
Fourth down.
Penalty was declined. Brings on the punting unit. Alan Boardman again in for BYU. James Dye back deep for Utah State. 25 balls on the 21-yard line here. Boardman, you see his punting so far on the day. This will be his second punt. 42-yarder was just under his average last time. Puts away nicely, not too much hang time. Dye will have a little bit of room to return this one as he does so on the 30-yard line. Shoots a gap, gets to work his way to midfield. One blocker, there's a flag. And at about the 27-yard line, James Dye gets two before he has run out of bounds. There are three flags coloring the field, however. They're all about the area where we saw a lethal block.
Well, I think it's number 29. Here's Dye who takes off. We're going to try to find Corey Alexander on the play and the clip. We can't see him here. There it is right there. There's Corley Alexander hitting a BYU player from behind, and that is a clip, and that's the flag.
And now there was a penalty on BYU on that as well, unless the official might have gotten his directions off a little bit. So we can get the explanation.
By the receiving team. After the play, dead ball, personal foul. It's a kicking team.
Well, according to the official, there was no clip on that play.
Block in the back on Utah State, and then there was a personal foul on BYU on the same play.
Not technically a clip, but the penalties both ways leaves the ball in pretty good shape for the Aggies.
In Cougar territory, first and 10 at the 40-yard line. Profell Greer gets the fake. Calvillo going deep. He's got a man wide open. Wide open. Cody McMahon. Touchdown. Utah State. They strike quickly. 40-yard touchdown pass. Somebody in the BYU defensive secondary is going to look at these highlights. Try to figure out what happened there. There wasn't anybody within about 8 yards of Cody McMahon.
I think one of the things that happened was the play fake was so good. Everybody thought Greer had the ball, and that probably bought Calvillo some time.
Utah State strikes here. We haven't even gone 2 minutes into this second half. And the kick is up and good, and Utah State jumps out to a 27-14 lead here in the early going of the second half, picking up where they left off. Score, Utah State 27, Brigham Young University 14. We'll be back in a moment right after this. We're back. Romney Stadium is alive and well. Thank you very much. 27-14, Utah State. Tyler Anderson takes the ball 1 yard deep in his own end zone. Trying to shoot a gap as well, and he does. He's got one man to beat to the end zone. That's number 21. And Tyler Anderson returns the favor with a 101-yard touchdown kickoff return. Amazing.
I'm really not sure, Carlton, if he was even touched. About at the 30 or 35, he changed hands with the ball, dodged an Aggie, but the blocking really fell into place for him.
Michael Cole was the last man that really had a chance. We'll take a look at this again.
There are a couple of Aggies blocked right out of his way. I don't think he's been touched yet. Maybe a hand on him by that defender, but he's off. He's through. That's history.
That's the speed of Tyler Anderson. I tell you, he looks fast when he goes back and forth from the huddle. You put him on a 101-yard sprint, and that's what can happen. Well, BYU jumps right back into this thing. They've now got 20 points, and they're awaiting the extra point. There's Montezaki running into the team there at the last minute to give him that 11th person. And the clock has just gone to 0-0. There is the delay of game penalty.
take him back another 5 yards. Should still not be much of a problem for Joe Herrick. This extra point is rather important, however, because right now they stand a full touchdown away. And if they were not to do so, it would take them away from a possible tie. Tyler Anderson's out of Orem, Utah. He, one of his notables before this return was he caught Ty Detmer's last touchdown pass in the Holiday Bowl back in 91. And there's the kick. And it is good. BYU pulls in 27-21 now. We've got 12 minutes, 50 seconds left in the third quarter. That's just 2 minutes and 10 seconds.
Well, we got a chance as the two teams reconnoiter. We have one of the great names in Aggie sports with us, Cornell Green, who is here for the weekend and the Hall of Fame induction and all that surrounds that and the introduction of the All-Century team. And you kind of come here not really as a two-sport guy because you didn't play football at Utah State. You were a great basketball player, but we know you distinguished yourself in the NFL with the Cowboys. Good to see you again, Cornell.
It's great being here. It's a great honor to be here.
What do you think of this football game? This is a lot of offense here.
I think it's a great game. This is the type I like. As you know, I'm a scout for the Denver Broncos now, and I'm also scouting some of the players out here. And so to give you a chance to get a good opinion of them.
I assume you're here because you think there's some players here as well, a chance to scout while you're here on a weekend at Utah State. Who do you see you like?
Well, it's kind of hard to say. I see a lot of them I like, but I don't know how well I like it until I get around and actually put the report on them. So I'm just here doing an overall scouting job, and I'll probably come back later in the year to see how they're doing.
There we see on the screen, as we see Lavelle Edwards, Dallas Cowboys from 62-74. And again, somebody asked you the other day, why did you play football after a great basketball career at Utah State? I think the answer was because it was the first thing I tried out for in the pros.
Right, that's it. That's the only thing you did do. First one I made, first team that offered me a contract, and so that's the one I signed.
That was a nice event last night, wasn't it?
That was a great event. Super. I really enjoyed it. You got to meet a lot of old people that I hadn't seen in 20 years. So it was just really super.
We just had the ball go into the end zone for a touchback here as the teams are changing possession now. The speed of a Tyler Anderson, what did you notice about that kickoff return?
No, I didn't get to see much of it. I just saw the last of it, but nobody was going to catch him. The kid's got great speed. I didn't realize he was that fast, but the kid's got great speed.
Speed like that in the pros, have you had a chance to look at Tyler earlier on?
No, I haven't. This is the first time seeing anybody on either team.
You got first and 10. Balls up 20. Calvillo rolling out, finds Aubrey Thompson. He falls down just past the first down marker, about an 11-yard gain, gets to the 31.
Since your years in the NFL as a player, what have you been doing? I know you worked for the Cowboys for a while.
I'm a scout now for the Denver Broncos. I've been with the Broncos about the last 8 years now. So I was scouting for the Cowboys, and I just switched over to the Broncos.
Still maintaining a residence in Texas, though?
Yes, still living in Dallas.
Didn't you have some of your family come to Utah State at one point?
We have an adopted daughter here, was here. She graduated from here also.
When you're scouting for the pros, what kinds of things do you look for in a player just overall?
Well, overall, just athletic ability. That's about the only thing you can really judge on paper, just athletic ability. You can't judge. A lot of things you can't judge, you just hope they have it.
There you saw, going for Aubrey Thompson again. He was the go-to man in the first half. Over Calvillo overthrows him there, brings up a second down play. But you look for teachability with that athletic
ability? Well, you assume they all got that there in college. You assume you can teach all of them. It's just overall athletic ability is really the only thing in speed. And size. That counts.
All that helps, yeah.
I think one of the comments the guys coming back to this event this weekend have had, before anything else, is boy, Logan's changed.
It has really changed. As a matter of fact, I couldn't find those two union buildings. I spent a lot of time there.
Calvillo back rolling and finds Cody McMahon there at about the 48-yard line. Stopped by Vic Tarleton. That's first down yardage for Utah State. It's about 16 yards on that pass play to the 47-yard line.
Well, again, Cornell's here, and he was inducted into the Utah State Hall of Fame last night with L.J. Sylvester, Annette Cottle, Mary Lou Ram Flippin, Dick Romney, Doc Nelson, Fern Gardner, Kent Ryan, Ralph Vaughn, Wayne Estes, Bear Ward, Merlin Olsen. That's pretty good company.
Great company.
You saw McMahon's numbers there. He's already got 109 yards receiving. That's on three catches, so he's really getting the most out of his catches. Travis Hall providing pressure for Calvillo, and then he's brought down, it looks like, Lenny Gomes that finally got him down.
Hall came in from the outside and forced Calvillo up the pocket.
Well, Cornell, it's good to see you again. Good to welcome you back to Logan, and keep in touch with us and keep an eye on some of these Aggies and Cougars. Maybe you can get them on the Broncos lineup.
I'll do that. Thanks, Sam.
Thanks for joining us. Clock is ticking. 11 minutes, 20 seconds left here in the third quarter. We've got second down, 12 yards to go following the two-yard loss that we just saw. James Dye is in the backfield now for the Aggies. The fake to Dye. And then the flare pass right out to Aubrey Thompson. If he can keep his momentum, he'll get the first down, and he does. About 2 yards past, and he gets to the 41-yard line of BYU.
That's his eighth catch of this game, and that'll be one of the longer ones for him today. So he leads the Aggies in receiving today.
They're calling his number early and often.
There he is diving for the first down as he's jumped upon by Frank Christensen there.
First and 10. Went up the middle. For a gain of about 4 yards before he's dropped, that's James Dye. Corey Cook in on the stop. Randy Brock there as well. It's about 6 now. If you count the forward motion, brings up second down, 4 yards to go. The Aggies are back in Cougar territory again, and we might get that offensive showdown that we saw glimpses of during the first half. Jack DeMooney with coverage there. That was Xavier Foreman, just couldn't hang on to the ball. He would have had about a 2 yard gain. He could have tried to break it open for first down yardage.
The Aggies using Foreman there. Now they're bringing in Greg Thompson. We haven't seen him for several games. He's been hurt. He's been back lately to be the long snapper on the punts, but he's in a tight end. And after that last catch by Aubrey Thompson, he has not set foot on the field again. So the tight end is now Greg Thompson, setting to the left with the three wideouts to the right.
Third down, 3 yards to go. That's Greer up in motion at the top of your screen. Calvillo looks considerable pressure, gets it away to Tony Jenkins. He gets to about the 22-yard line before he's knocked down. That's another first down for Utah State. Muirbrook and Mitchell with the stop for BYU.
Quick little look in for Calvillo. He was the third, actually the middleman of the three wideouts to the right side, and Calvillo was under pressure, as he has been at times here, and he still gets rid of the ball. I think he's done a real good job in face of what pressure that BYU has brought with Pitts and Gomes and Brock and sometimes Travis Hall.
Ball is marked at the 24-yard line. Another first and 10. The Aggies driving. Calvillo back looking. And Aubrey Thompson with a nice diving catch gets about 3 yards on that, moves him up to the 21-yard line. Nice catch for Aubrey on that kind of tough pass route. Tough for the passer and tough for the receiver. BYU making a few substitutions there.
Coming into this game, Aubrey's top game this year was 7 catches for 93 yards against Nevada. He surpassed that.
Greer again in motion to the top of your screen. Lee, Alexander, and Turner at the bottom of your screen. Calvillo rolling to his right, and he's got a wide open field. He can make it to the end zone. And that's an unopposed touchdown for Anthony Calvillo. However, there is a flag on the play, and the official has been kind enough to give us an early indication that it was a hold. Calvillo found his room based on that.
Turner and Alexander and Lee were all set out to the right side. They were all covered, and sometimes it's interesting that BYU's coverage has been good a lot of the day today, to the point that Calvillo is forced to run, and actually it turns out backfiring on BYU's defense. They've defended well and forced the run, and again Calvillo turns out to be the leading runner on this Utah State team today.
Look at the penalties so far today. 75 yards for Brigham Young. You talk about this, they're using so many defensive backs to cover the receivers of Utah State that it seems like they're forced to leave a huge hole in the middle if Calvillo is able to find it. Second down, 25 yards to go. The ball is way back on the 39-yard line now. Vujovicin finds Mike Lee. He eludes one tackler, trying to work through a couple more, gets to the 28-yard line before he's brought down by number 91, Dwayne Williams of BYU.
They had three wideouts to the left, and again, Lee is always, or almost always, the guy on the shorter routes, as I think in that case, McMahon and possibly Alexander were running routes toward the end zone. He breaks his off and catches the short pass and carry from the 39 down inside the 30 on this one.
Three wideouts moving to the bottom of your screen. McMahon, Jenkins, and Lee. Greer moves in motion to the top. Calvillo, and it almost intercepted number 35, Frank Christensen, had his hands on the ball. Calvillo trying to find number 8, Mike Lee, and unable to do so. Christensen had a golden opportunity at a turnover of his own.
Here's the replay of it. It was right in his hands as Lee was diving for it behind Christensen, but he was positioned with an interception and didn't make it. Only three interceptions by this BYU secondary or defense all year. That's an awfully low number.
And we're bringing on the kicking unit here for a field goal attempt of about, it'll be about 46 yards if I'm right. The kick is up. It's got the distance. And it's good. Nate Morreale with, again, the longest kick of his Utah State year so far this year. Puts the Aggies up by 9, 30-21. We've got 8 minutes, 6 seconds left in the third quarter. We've seen a lot of firepower already. We'll be back right after this.
We found out that a lot of the cost of the airplane was not in building it, but in rebuilding it and rebuilding it until we got it right.
It's the largest and most complex aircraft to be designed entirely electronic. No paper drawings and no full-scale mock-ups. A candid behind-the-scenes look at the space-age systems and the people involved in producing the Boeing 777, 21st century jet.
Watch it Monday at 9.
Back in Logan, 8 minutes, 6 seconds left in the third quarter. Utah State has jumped out to a 9-point lead, and here's the kickoff. Again, Tyler Anderson, they avoid Tyler this time. They get it to Tim Nowatzki, who takes it 1 yard deep in the end zone. And he's tripped up by number 21, Michael Coe. Gets to about the 17-yard line.
Tyler Anderson had come over to block for Nowatzki. Coe just got rid of Anderson and went right to Nowatzki and made a nice kickoff breaking play to limit the yardage that time. Of course, they're awfully cognizant of what happened the time before, because basically BYU second half offense, and this is the third possession now, has been one kickoff return.
There's a look at the scoring drive there, capped off by Morreale's season high 47 yard field goal. First and 10, that's Walsh. Chad Doles next to him. Walsh looks and fires incomplete to Tim Nowatzki, and he took a hit. Took a hit from Michael Coe. Jermaine Younger there as well. That's the kind of thing you remember when you get back to the huddle.
Well, the Ag defensive lineman on the rush got up slowly. There's Walsh firing, Nowatzki dropping, and Coe delivering a blow.
Second down 10, Bryce Doman coming into the game for BYU. Utah State defense has penetrated when they need to. The flare out, and Jamal Willis just simply wasn't looking. I don't know who was in error there. We'll see as they approach each other in the huddle, but Jamal Willis appeared to be looking the other direction.
Well, they're talking about it now, and Walsh definitely has an opinion on where Willis should have gone, and it's not the same opinion that Willis has.
And regardless of that, it's third down and 10 yards to go. Getting the score flashed over to us. Utah has jumped out 24-20 over San Diego in their game. And he's dropped. Gary Brown comes in, providing the pressure on John Walsh and sacks him. It's his first sack of the season. And again, the BYU offense has gone nowhere but backwards here in this third quarter.
Brown is the starting linebacker today, blitzing on this play. He was playing in place of Bobby Singer and making the most of the opportunity. Gary Brown is a veteran linebacker, but he's been hurt a lot this year. He's a junior out of Oakland, California.
Lost 19 yards on that offensive set. Alan Boardman standing in his own end zone there to punt the ball. James Dye back deep for Utah State to receive it. Whistles were blowing before the ball was snapped. And I see double zeros over here on the play clock. It'll be another penalty against BYU. Now Boardman is backing up to his line of demarcation there. He's standing in front of that orange post.
After that sack, BYU, the sack yardage goes on the rushing totals. BYU's rushing total is minus 19 in this game.
Well, James Dye standing on his own 46-yard line. Boardman is standing against the white line of the end zone. A lot of pressure on the deep snapper on a play like this.
The Aggies are bringing just about everybody, but they don't get there.
Ball takes a Cougar bounce, and Dye picks it up at the 50-yard line, looking for some room, and he's got negative yardage, and if he's not careful, now he's got some openings around the left side of the field. He gets over to the 35-yard line before he's knocked out of bounds. Very courageous.
Well, Ephraim Haymore made the key block on that one right in the middle of the field that sprung Dye down the sideline, and now a flag is thrown in front of the BYU bench well after the play.
One of the players that is not dressed out was on the field.
It's probably, well, I shouldn't say what I was going to think. I had a thought. But there goes Dye on the way. I don't know if we saw the block by Haymore, but it was a key one.
And there you see the punter was the one who had to knock him out of bounds. Let's see if we can catch this penalty.
Dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct on the bench. 15 yards, first down.
Again, penalties, turnovers. And one of the coaching staff members here on the sidelines, that's Pete Whitbeck, the associate athletic director, is pleading for mercy, trying to get in between whoever the offending party was. Well, Utah State has the ball well into Cougar territory here. Ball's on the 22-yard line. First and 10, Calvillo back looking and finding Cody McMahon at the 2-yard line. He works his way free and gets to about what I would assume about the 3-inch line.
On the play now, Mitchell, number 30, and Cook, number 17, collide simultaneously at the point of the catch with McMahon, and he almost got in the end zone because they knocked each other out of the play. Here's Calvillo looking all the way for McMahon. There's the catch. There's Mitchell. There's Cook. And they knock each other down. McMahon heads for the end zone and finally brought down by Jack DeMooney.
Utah State is knocking on the door. They're inside the 1-yard line. McMahon now with 129 yards receiving. Calvillo keeps it. And it's a touchdown. Utah State is taking control of this game. They are now up 36-21. This is the offense that the Aggies have had all year long, and they're succeeding now against the BYU defense, which is stumbling. We've got 6 minutes and 16 seconds left here in the third quarter, and the Aggies are now on the field to attempt the extra point. And it's good. Takes the score to 37 as Utah State now has a 16-point lead here in Logan, Utah. The fans are loving every minute of it. 37-21, back in a moment right after this. We're back in Logan, Utah. Utah State has taken control of this game, and if BYU's not careful, it could go further.
Oh, I love to point this out. We started the game with me talking about that 1980 game when the Aggies scored 46 points. This is the most they've scored since then against BYU.
We told you we'd get you a history lesson here today. All of you fans have gotten your history lesson on this Saturday. 6 minutes, 13 seconds. Kickoff takes them up to about the 37-yard line. We've got a player that's down on the field.
That's Dennis Simmons, who is a backup linebacker for this team and plays on a lot of the special teams, and the trainers are out there now attending to him over near the Aggie sideline.
The Cougars are losing another linebacker.
A lot of you Aggie fans and BYU fans remember a game back in 1983 between these two teams in Provo that was won by BYU, a controversial game. When the Aggies thought they'd had a turnover in possession of the ball, Steve Young was the quarterback that year. BYU won at 38-34 and has gone on to win 10 straight games in the series against Utah State. That is the most, 34 points is the most the Aggies have scored in the series up until now since that game in the early 80s when McMahon and Galliano went at it here in this stadium. So we're seeing a lot of offense, and again, BYU's got the potential to do some damage and get back in this game. We saw that last week.
Last week, that's right. John Walsh threw for over 400 yards in that second half alone, 5 touchdown passes. So at that rate, it would take BYU up to 35 points. Let's look at the scoring drive here. Calvillo, the one-yard touchdown run after the big pass to Cody McMahon to take him down to the one-foot line.
And even go back before that, when Haymore threw the block to Spring Dye on the nice return and then the flag on the sideline, somebody on the BYU bench got the team in trouble and gave the Aggies even better field position.
Cougars are now the injured player Dennis Simmons is being brought to the sideline. Now first and 10, ball's at the 37-yard line. Walsh out of the shotgun. They give to Willis up the middle, working his way around the left side. He's got a little bit of room. Gets across the 46-yard line, about 1 yard shy of the first down. That's Donald Toomer and Travis Scow with a stop for Utah State.
Nice block in there by Steve Christensen on Trimble in the upper part of the secondary beyond the linebackers. Christensen really helps Willis on this play. In fact, you see him right there, and Willis cuts off the block. Trimble can't get to him. Willis heads to the sideline.
Willis, the single setback here on the next play. There's a take a look at Jamal Willis out of Las Vegas. Give to Willis up the middle. Now he's trying to get some room and is unable to do so. Met by Gary Brown. The linebacker looks like he's close to the first down yardage. Probably has gotten it. Yeah, it's first down, BYU.
Jermaine Younger went flying by and had a shot at him, but couldn't grab hold, and then it was the other linebacker there. You see number 26, Gary Brown, made the stop.
10 minutes into this quarter, this is BYU's first down. They have had several three and outs, and they've been getting, they've been heading south with their offense early on. You look at the first downs overall there, 16 for Utah State. Out of the shotgun, John Walsh, first down, 10 yards to go. And finds a sliding Micah Matsuzaki at the 38-yard line.
Just a simple sprint down and turn in, and Walsh spots him. Walsh got good protection. There was a rush from the outside, but he steps inside of it and throws, and there's Matsuzaki on a sliding catch inside the 40-yard line.
There's Bryce Doman bringing the play in to John Walsh. Tim Nowatzki also in the game for the Cougars. First and 10 again. Ball's at the 38-yard line. Out of the I formation for the Cougars. They block the Walsh, who continues to backpedal, throws the screen pass out to Willis, who's going to take a loss on this play as he's drowning in a sea of blue. Trimble and Co. there first for Utah State.
Donald Toomer also did a pretty good job in reading and reacting quickly to the screen that Walsh had set up.
Tyler Anderson coming into the game. That's UC sprinting in to the huddle. As I mentioned, he even looks fast doing that. Matsuzaki at the top of your screen. And he's going for Matsuzaki. Matsuzaki makes the catch. Was able to utilize his speed, get underneath the ball. Gets to the 10-yard line before he's brought down by Ephraim Haymore.
That's a really tough thing to do when you have to completely turn your body around. You think the ball's going to be delivered over one shoulder, and it comes over the other. Here's Walsh stepping up against a pretty good rush. Matsuzaki by now has turned to the inside, and to keep concentration on that, that's remarkable. That's a great catch.
Look at Micah Matsuzaki out of Honolulu, Hawaii. Broke a lot of hearts when he chose to come to BYU. Hawaii thought they had one of their own. We're just inside of 4 minutes left here in the third quarter. Willis on the left side of Walsh. Christensen on the right side to give to Willis. Trying to shoot some gaps. gets a yard or so. Younger in on the stop there for Utah State.
And one of the unsung heroes on the BYU line, Jim Edwards, absolutely blew Scott Nawala to the outside and allowed Willis on the draw to get the yards inside the 10.
Second down, 9 yards to go. Cougars deep in Aggie territory. You see that strange alignment there. Walsh throwing for Matsuzaki, overthrows him. There was some contact there at about the 1 yard line. Matsuzaki claiming that number 22 Donald Toomer was interfering with him. The official says no. And the official is always right. Rule number one. If the rule number two is if the official's ever wrong, refer to rule number one.
That's right.
Third down, 9 yards to go.
That's the way it works.
The Cougar bench found that out a little while ago. Bryce Doman moving to the top of your screen. Tim Nowatzki down at the bottom corner. Wolf back looking up the middle. Finds Nowatzki if he held onto the ball. He did. He's getting up a little. That's actually Bryce Doman. I'm sorry. Bryce Doman with that reception there. He did hang on to the ball.
Doman starts out as a wide receiver to the right. He's in some traffic, as you can see, but he comes across the middle. Keeps the concentration as Damon Smith is chasing. Smith finally makes the tackle, but Doman makes a great fingertip catch inside the three.
Fourth down, 3 yards to go. The Cougars are going for it. Jamal Willis, the single setback for the Cougars, and we've got a stoppage in play as BYU calls a timeout. Fourth and three, a very critical play for the Cougars. They want to make sure they know everything they can. As Walsh now trots over to the sidelines. Get some last-minute instructions from the coaching staff, and we will take a break. We've got 2 minutes, 30 seconds left here in the third quarter. Utah State still ahead by 16, 37 to 21. Back in a moment. We're back. 2 minutes, 30 seconds left in the third quarter. We see some... interesting footwear. I don't know if Nike will pick up on that or not. Fourth down, 3 yards to go. Big play in the Cougar drive. Jamal Willis, a single setback to BYU. Fake to Willis. Walsh rolling out. He throws and it's incomplete. And the fans go nuts. Official says he dropped it. That was Michael Coe with coverage. Attempting to find Matsuzaki. Matsuzaki still pleading his case. And so the Aggies will take over on their own 3 yard line here, first and 10.
There's Walsh being chased by Younger, and then he throws into the end zone for Salioni. And Coe is right there. Actually, if Walsh, who's not really fast at foot, had kept maybe heading upfield, he might have gotten what he needed that way in retrospect. But the Aggies take over.
Mobility might have hurt him. His knee is still hurting him. It was swollen up after the game last week with Fresno, but he did practice all week. Not quite at 100%. Calvillo back in his own end zone. And misfires for 7, Aubrey Thompson. Here another historical note. If there is a safety in this game, this will be the first time ever in this entire series that dates all the way back to 1922 that a safety has been scored here in Logan in this series between BYU.
Thank you, Orville Paller, for that. There's the guy that researches everything about these in-state series between all the schools and does it. He has a book out that is fascinating to read.
More history for you this fine football afternoon. Calvillo rolling out, finds maybe a yard or so, chased out of bounds. Brings up third down.
That was all Calvillo could do just to get out of the end zone and get back to the line of scrimmage. Third largest crowd, Carlton, in the history of the stadium. 26,328.
And they're getting their money's worth today.
I think every one of them has been for BYU, Utah State.
Just look at the crowd there. Happy people on a beautiful day here in Logan, Utah. Third down, 9 yards to go. Calvillo back, flushed out of the pocket, doesn't have much room. He just lets it go, and he's got Tony Jenkins open. Oh, he was hit.
And the crowd wants pass interference. That was Vic Carlton with coverage.
Well, the Utah State bench has absolutely erupted. They thought it was clearly pass interference on Tarleton, and Charlie Weatherby's 5 yards out on the field. Here's Calvillo in big trouble. We almost had the safety Orville Pallers looking for. Calvillo throws it way downfield. It's like a Hail Mary from your own end zone. I don't know if we're going to be able to see any of the action at the end of it. There's Tarleton with Jenkins.
Yeah, that's close. You can see why the Aggie bench was upset. They, however, did avoid the penalty that was called on the Cougar bench. Now, this brings up an interesting situation punting-wise. That's Micah Knorr. Now, he is back where Alan Boardman was a little while ago with his foot against the white line. And he does get it away relatively easily. And at the 40-yard line, that's Matsuzaki.
David,
the 32, a little bit extra hitting there.
David Gill and Paul Gustafson are the two that initially got him, 44 and 28 there on your screen. A couple of backup defenders and special teams specialists.
Well, the Cougars get excellent field position here when they probably need it the most. There's just over 2 minutes left here in the third quarter. They've got first and 10. They're in the Aggie territory at the Aggie 32-yard line. Walsh again out of the shotgun. Willis and Christensen there on his other side. Walsh not finding who he was originally looking for. And Tim Nowatzki steps in front of Damon Smith and makes the catch at the 10-yard line. Deja vu.
He and Matsuzaki were the wideouts to the right side. They had Tyler Anderson set to the left. And there goes Walsh, and it's Nowatzki in front of Smith, and then the immediate stop there at the 10.
That takes John Walsh's totals to 353 yards passing as we take a look at Tim Nowatzki out of Michigan City, Indiana. His uncle Tom Nowatzki played for both the Lions and the Colts in the NFL after a career at the University of Indiana. First and 10. And that ball was batted away at the line.
Well, that
celebrating
was,
that one, yeah.
Yeah, Scott Mawala on your screen there. The challenge for Mawala and Danielle Tapman, who are not huge defensive ends, was are they quick enough to negate the size of Mike Empey, the tackle 300-pounder, and Eli Herring on the other side, 335. And it's been a good battle today between the Aggie defensive line and BYU's big offensive front.
Mawala has put on 60 pounds since he entered Utah State. Try to make up for that size differential. Second down, 10 yards to go. Again, Walsh out of the shotgun. Flushed out of the pocket and throws at the last minute. And there was a punishing blow delivered by, looks like 96 was a Taplin and Michael Cole.
Yeah. Now that throw was a bullet from short range. Now that's a tough one for Tyler Anderson to hold on to. He was in traffic. It was delivered right there, but you got to have a little bit of time to react. And the way Walsh throws it, Tyler didn't have much time.
And maybe that was the mobility of Walsh that kind of forced that play to develop the way that it did. Third down. Ball still at the 10 after two incomplete passes. Walsh looks and finds Nowatzki, and he goes in unopposed. Touchdown, BYU. Right up the middle and shot through it. BYU moves out now with 27 points on the board.
Walsh in the shotgun. His back's released into patterns, by the way, and he finds the delaying Nowatzki over the middle and no problem.
And so the Cougar touchdown has kind of silenced the crowd here at Romney Stadium. 37-27 before the extra point. And now it's 37-28. As Utah State still hangs on to a 9-point lead. We've got 1 minute, 18 seconds left in the third quarter. We've seen a lot of scoring in this past 15 minutes. Back in a moment, right after this. We're back in Logan, Utah. Carlton Wing along with Craig Hislop. We mentioned at halftime how BYU had a trouble scoring in the third quarter. They'd only scored 28 points going into this game. In the third quarter so far, they've scored 14, which is half of what they had done all year in the third quarter. There's the kickoff. James Dye back, takes it about the 3-yard line.
runs into a traffic jam at the 31-yard line where he is stopped.
Well, that statistic makes me wonder if they haven't scored their entire season of third quarter points in the last two games, because last week against Fresno State was a show, and don't ever, ever, ever put BYU out of a game like this one with Walsh in there, even though he doesn't have Eric Bridge, who's out of the game. But we saw last week what this offense could do. We're in for a heck of a game the rest of the way.
That's true. Fasten your seatbelts, folks. There's a look at the latest scoring drive. 32 yards, four plays. Capped off by the touchdown. There's Calvillo going deep, and he's got McMahon separating himself from the coverage. Dives and is unable to come down with the ball. Just as the ball went up in the air, he just distanced himself from Patrick Mitchell. Then that's tough to do. Look at the play here again as it unfolds.
Yeah, nice play fake, and then Calvillo gets a chance to put a lot of air under this one, as they say, and Cody just can't get to it.
Mitchell is on the he competes in track for BYU as well. He's on the 400-meter relay team for BYU. They won the WAC championship. He is a speedy one, so to be able to separate himself like that is very impressive. Calvillo fakes the run and goes deep again. He's got Sean Turner open this time. Turner makes the catch, and he gets dropped at about the 15-yard line. That's Vic Tarleton.
Now, Turner started out on the right side of this formation. We had two wide receivers to the left. And Turner was the wide out to the right side. So he comes down the sideline in front of the BYU bench as Calvillo's running away from him, actually. And now he cuts toward the middle, and he makes a nice catch. He hasn't made a lot of catches this year, but you can see he's a good one.
Well, that's a 59-yarder that he will remember for a little while as the Aggies are right back inside the Cougars' red zone, attempting another score. We might get another touchdown on the board here before this quarter is out. Profell Greer in the backfield. The give to Greer up the middle. He's got room. Gets to the 2-yard line before he is tackled. To Mooney and Cook in on the stop for BYU, but this is almost a replay of the Fresno State game last week when everybody would score. And so far, Utah State has shown themselves to be unstoppable here in the second half.
Well, there was some blocking that was done there, right in the whole middle of the line. Tilski, Warren Bowers, Darren Mitchell did a great job.
20 seconds left here in the third quarter. Aggies hanging on to a 9-point lead. Calvillo barking out orders to his team. And the quick pass to McMahon. Incomplete.
Just a little release to the outside in the corner of the end zone. And I think the question there was, did he have control of the ball? I guess he didn't. We couldn't see it from where we were.
Well, the cannons fired anyway. They thought that it was a touchdown.
Here's the throw right toward the camera. McMahon stretching out and comes down. We can't tell if he's controlling it. He appeared to be in bounds.
Yeah, it was in bounds, but he must have been bobbling it all the way down. The cannon operator is not as close as we are. There's Greer, who slips and falls at the 3-yard line. About a 1-yard loss on that play. Looks like that's the end of the quarter. Kind of snuck up on us there as we were paying attention to other things. At the end of three, Brigham Young University 28, Utah State 37. Back with the fourth quarter and a wild one right after this.
They gave us the banquet, the toga, the keystone arch, water conduits, and Roman numerals. They were the Etruscans. Now you have a once-in-a-lifetime chance to see their treasures direct from the Vatican Museums to Brigham Young University's new Museum of Art. Premier exhibit October 18th through April 30th. For tickets and information, call 378-BYU1.
Back in Logan, fourth quarter action. We want to take a look at this play here.
At the end of it now, as the ball comes down and stretching out is McMahon. Let's watch the completion of it as he goes tumbling. He must still be juggling it. The ball eventually rolls out here. Watch near the pylon. I think we'll see the ball right there go rolling away.
And we've got third down and three with the action on the field. Calvillo back looking, gunning, and firing, completing. To Tony Jenkins, touchdown, Utah State. What a way to begin the fourth quarter. 4 seconds into it, another touchdown for the Aggies. As they put their 23rd point on the board here in the second half. 43-28, they now lead it.
Boy, he just rifled this to Jenkins in the end zone. Really, I guess, accredited with a 3-yard pass.
See Morreale there on the field. Kick is up and good. So Utah State now point number 24 in the second half. They've got 44 overall. BYU has 28 here. We've just begun the fourth quarter. Folks, we'll be back right after this. Back in Logan, 14 minutes 56 seconds left in one of the more exciting games in recent memory here in Logan, Utah. There's the kick. Tim Nowatzki moving up to field the catch. Gets to the 25. On over to the 32-yard line before he's brought down.
The original trip up there by number 28 for the Aggies, Paul Gustafson. Right now, after that drive for the Aggies to score to make it 44-28, and of course a big play was the big pass to Sean Turner of nearly 60 yards. Calvillo is out tossing Walsh to the tune of 370 to 363.
Got some scores also happening here. Utah is ahead of San Diego State. That's been a seesaw battle. They've got a 4-point lead in Salt Lake City. Walsh fires and complete to Micah Matsuzaki at the 40-yard line, a 7-yard gain. Travis Scow with a stop for Utah State.
Matsuzaki was the motion man. You saw him coming back toward the slot man and then head up and over the middle. There he is there now, running past his slot guy on sort of a slant. Scow's with him. There's the toss and the quick tackle by Travis Scow.
Second down, 3 yards to go. Again, Walsh out of the shotgun. Aggies showing blitz. And the holes weren't plugged, and Jamal Willis has some open real estate. It's a foot race, and he's rugged down at about the 16-yard line.
Well, you're right. The Aggies were showing it, and boy, what a play call for a blitzing situation. In other words, when the Aggies are blitzing, they've got people coming upfield, and Willis quickly headed the other way before any reaction, and a nice run.
One of the things Lavelle said was that UCLA did blitz very effectively. And Fresno State was not able to do so as effectively. They tried a few times. They were burned by John Walsh in his quick release. And so they didn't try it very much more for the rest of the game. First down, 10 yards to go. Ball's on the 16-yard line of Utah State. Walsh back, feeling the pressure, eludes it, and then fires a shot to Jamal Willis that Willis just couldn't get his hands on.
Now, Walsh is saying, Carlton, that one of the Aggie defenders, and I think he's looking at number 91, David Balls, had a hand on his face mask. There's Balls reaching in. We may not be able to see that, but Balls was reaching in and trying to get a hand on Walsh as he was trying to throw the ball. Walsh gets away now and escapes, and on the run throws it. That was after the little conflagration.
Second down, 10. Ball still on the 16-yard line. The give to Willis. Motors ahead to the 10-yard line. 64 yards rushing on the day for Jamal Willis. Pratt Lyons with a stop for Utah State. Clock is ticking at 13:36 left in the game. Cougars are down by 16 points. Look at the another score here. This is a big whack battle. Fresno State going to Laramie and coming away so far. Fourth quarter score with an 11-point lead. Tough to do in Laramie as well. The Aggies blitz again, and Jamal Willis has open running room again. Thrusts himself to about the 1-yard line.
Well, with the lead, the Aggies are showing an even greater willingness to try those things. They had David Gill, a backup linebacker, coming all the way, and again he grabbed Walsh almost immediately, but by then Willis had the handoff, and I guess the Aggie that's down is Jermaine Younger.
Now that would be a shot to the Aggie defense. He is rolling around a little bit. He was providing a lot of that initial pressure on that blitz. Here's a look at Jamal Willis's number. Now he has 73 yards on the day. He's actually a running back.
Well, right now the Aggies with younger down are looking at the loss of a guy that means as much to their defense as Todd Hergett and Hall. And you can see what that's done to BYU today.
Younger's the returning Big West Defensive Player of the Year. He pops up, has the appearance that he will be back in the game. Leads the team in tackles coming into this game. He had 81 tackles, came off an excellent game last week. 11 tackles, let's see, there was an interception, two fumble recoveries, a sack. He really manhandled UNLV. Now we've got first down, 2 yards to go. First and goal at the two for BYU. To give to Willis, and looks like he maybe got half a yard.
He went into that hole as tentatively as he has run today. I guess he could see immediately that the blocking had broken down. Aggies going with at least one extra defensive line, only Sean Griswold, number 93. The Aggie defensive front just crashed in there, and Willis didn't look very confident at all as he took that handoff.
Take a look at how both teams have been able to move the ball. 454 yards so far for Utah State. That is amazing.
Passing totals are identical at 370 for both teams.
And there's Willis. Just kind of tiptoes behind the blockers. Touchdown, BYU. Well, the Cougars get back into the swing of things. They are now 10 points down. We've got just over 12 minutes as you see Willis waltzing his way through there. Jamal Willis there, 75 yards. You see the WR, we'll say that stands for Western Runner. Not wide receiver, he's a running back. And there's Joe Herrick in for the extra point. Try to bring the Cougars to within 9 points, and he does so. Well, we'll see who gets to hold the ball last, and maybe we'll see who scores the last touchdown. We'll take a break now. 12 minutes, 16 seconds left in the game. It's a wild one. 35 points BYU, 44 for Utah State. Back in a moment. Back in Logan, 44 to 35. Carlton Wing here along with Craig Hislop bringing the action here on KJAZZ 14. It's been an exciting game in Logan. We're entering what we call the confidence factor. See if Utah State has the ability to nail this shut. They haven't been able to do so in some of the early games this year. And they're being put to the test now with the potent BYU offense. That's Tony Jenkins taking the kickoff. Trying to find a gap. Finds one that gets him to about the 24-yard line.
Just looking back on that last drive now, Willis is up to about 75 or so yards. That's a rough estimate in the rushing totals today. He got 61 of them on that drive.
Well, there's the running game that Coach Edwards has been waiting for. Showed himself. There's a look at Calvillo's numbers. 370 yards already and 4 touchdown passes. And we got plenty of action left here. And then you see what he's been able to do on the ground. Calvillo back again, looking in the air. Finds Cody McMahon. Stopped by Patrick Mitchell, but gets to the 37-yard line. First down. It's the 38-yard line. Completion 14 yards.
Now, here's Calvillo on the toss to the sideline, and Mitchell's right there, but McMahon holds on, and a nice display of concentration. Last week, I thought a lot of the time the BYU secondary looked quite confused. Their coverages have been solid here for most of the afternoon.
Has to give out to James Dye. He's got some room around the left side. First down yardage and more. He gets to the 45-yard line of BYU in the Cougar territory again before he's knocked out of bounds by Shea Mearbrook.
The guy that had a shot at him was Jack DeMooney, but he just ran right by Jack. He was almost in the grasp, and the Aggie or the BYU defender couldn't finish the play.
First and 10, ball's at the 44. And San Diego has now pulled ahead of Utah. This seesaw battle is amazing. 34 to 31. James Dye up the middle, wrapped around by number 41, Brian Hughes. Gets about 4 yards on the carry. 11 minutes, 30 seconds, and counting left in this game. Second down, 6 yards to go. Now something to keep an eye on. Calvillo's nearing his career high in passing yardage. He's probably hovering around the 395 mark, and that would be his second best outing. fake to die, got some room, throws off balance, and overshoots the intended receiver, number 8, Michael Lee.
As the game drags along, and on that play you saw the play action fake, and then Calvillo throwing, he's doing a lot of that where he keeps it on the play action fake, and BYU is not even regarding the fake. They're going right for Calvillo. I'm sure Jim Zorn's got that in the back of his mind, too, that maybe one of these times these backs will take off with a handoff like Dye did a little while ago.
Third down, 6 yards to go. Calvillo has 4 wide receivers you see at the top of your screen. Lee, Alexander, and then that's Dye in motion to the bottom of your screen. Calvillo gunning and throws just behind Kevin Alexander. That was number 4.
Well, Alexander was in position for a nice game, but Anthony, who's thrown well today, did not throw his best ball on this one. He threw behind his receiver, even gave a better chance to the DB there to get it, or at least as good a chance as Alexander. Mitchell is in coverage.
Fourth down. You see before you now, that's Nate Morreale in to punt this one. He's going to gun for the sidelines and do what they call the coffin corner punt. Maybe not. Right up the middle it goes, and Aggies fall on it about the 4-yard line.
Credit David Gill in coverage. He's the guy that touched the ball and downed it there, so that puts the Cougars in a bit of a hole now as we're coming up on the final 10 minutes of this game, a 9-point football game. And by the way, reflecting back to that 1980 game, the 70-46 game, that's the most points ever scored by Utah State against Lavelle Edwards teams. But Aggies are 2 points away from that right now.
Away, yeah. Here's an update. Same score in the fourth quarter, 28-17, Fresno State over Wyoming. The ball was ended up being downed on the 7-yard line. Walsh fakes to Willis, throws to Christensen. Christensen can't hang on.
Christensen was just to the left of Walsh in the backfield as the play started. He was one of the two running backs, he and Willis back there, and he just cleared out to the flat. But they couldn't complete the pass.
This will be the test that the Aggie defense has been needing to prove themselves on. We go back to 3rd and 10 against Baylor and see when they were unable to stop them on that play, and that ended up costing them the game. Similar situations against Nevada. 2nd down, 10 yards to go. Walsh back in his own end zone. Fires from his feet behind the intended receiver, Tim Nowatzki.
Pretty substantial rush coming right up the middle from number 92, Pratt Lyons, a big freshman defensive tackle for Utah State.
It seemed like Walsh was able to get a full amount of meat on the ball there. He was on his back foot. He tried to throw that. Tyler Anderson now entering your screen with a play. 3rd and 10. Ball still at the 7-yard line. Utah State 44, BYU 35. 10.5 minutes left in the game. Walsh fires deep. He's got Tyler Anderson. And Anderson's open, and he will go in way unopposed. This will be a 93-yard touchdown run as Anderson does a little high-stepping.
And back at midfield at about the 45 or 47-yard line, Donald Toomer, the guy in coverage, has not yet gotten up. He was beaten on the play, grabbed his ankle immediately, and is still on the field.
Let's see if we can see it.
There it is on the sprint. Toomer's behind now. Well, they're even now. Toomer falls behind as he goes for the ball, misses it, and Anderson's home free again. This guy's involved in a couple of big plays in this game today.
Tyler Anderson looking like a rocket here as he crosses into the end zone. All he needs is a little miniskirt. 10 minutes, 25 seconds left, and BYU is back in this one really close now, 44-41, and we still have to wait for the extra point, and we still have an injured Donald Toomer. Look at a young Cougar fan. It's a little cold, but happy. A 93-yard touchdown pass. Is up now. He's still bending over, and now he's walked, and he just went down again. He's having some trouble there, and the coaches are going to help him off the field. It's like one of his legs or lower back problem. It's actually a 93-yard touchdown reception there for Tyler Anderson. Now we're ready for the extra point. And Joe Herrick puts it up. And good. 44 to 42. Amazing. An offensive outburst here in Logan, Utah, as the Aggies are clinging now to a two-point lead. Back with the rest of the game right after this.
Tanzania's Serengeti Plains, home to all kinds of wildlife, like these infant cheetah cubs. But the plains are also home to bigger cats. And that means home sweet home can be a dangerous place for cheetahs in the land of lions. Will they survive? Find out next time on Nature.
Watch it Tuesday at 8 and Saturday at 6.
Back in Logan, Utah. Got a barn burner here. The Aggies holding on to a two-point lead, 44 to 42. All the fans are up out of their seats on this one. And the kick rolls out of bounds. Touchback. Aggies take over the first and 10 on their 20. Take a look at the scoring drive there. 93 yards in three plays. There were two incomplete passes. And then one very big touchdown reception to Tyler Anderson.
Yeah, all of 21 seconds. I think that's pretty much what we can expect the rest of the game.
Well, it's time for the Aggie offense now to show that they can move the ball and hopefully, for Aggie's sake, eat some time off the clock. Profell Greer in the backfield. And Calvillo back looking for a receiver. Finds Aubrey Thompson and immediately steps out of bounds. Unintentionally, for about a four-yard gain, gets to the 24. Seconds left here in this game.
Thompson's ninth catch for 74 yards. Their total is up to 388 now passing the Aggies.
That's the give to Greer up the middle. He finds more room, was unable to elude the size of Shea Muirbrook, the freshman from Norco, California. It's about a two-yard gain on that play.
Randy Brock had the first shot at him right at the line of scrimmage, but Greer is a pretty strong little guy, slipped away, and then Muirbrook finished the play.
Third down, 4 yards to go. We're inside of 10 minutes now left in the game. Three wideouts to the left side. And then Greer goes to the top of the screen. Calvillo eludes, and he's got plenty of running room again. Gets the first down marker, and Moore gets to the 38-yard line before he plops himself down. Aggies keep the drive alive now. First and 10, ball at their own 38-yard line.
There's Calvillo headed right toward us, and again, the coverage obviously is there because he can't find anybody and continues to rack up the big rushing yards. I'm sure he's headed to one of his best rushing games as an Aggie.
That's true, and passing as well with 388. He's only 30 yards off of his career high. This is his second best performance as an Aggie quarterback. Being chased by Randy Brock. And looking downfield. Amazing, it was two receivers trying to converge there for the pass route. Sean Turner, you see there, is unable to come up with it. And we've got now an injured Cougar. It looks like Vic Tarleton that's down.
Well, Tarleton and Mitchell were there with the two Aggie receivers, Turner and Alexander. Here is Brock chasing Calvillo. He's cut down as Anthony throws it long down the sideline, and then there'll be a scramble for the ball. Turner had it for an instant, but couldn't control it. It was just absolutely knocked away by Tarleton and Mitchell in a nice defensive maneuver.
Both these quarterbacks are just gunning deep. Their balls are going high in the air here in the second half. The attendants are still working with Vic Tarleton. It looks like he's going to get up. This Jesse Lavelle taking a look at what's going on. The last thing he wants to see is another injury to his defense. He's seen enough already, he says. He says it's one of the craziest years he's ever had when it comes to injuries.
Well, again, the advantage this week was they had a whole week to patch the defense together instead of a half, like was the case, or even less than that, last week against Fresno State.
9 minutes, 8 seconds left in the game. Second down, 10. Ball is on the 38-yard line. Calvillo fakes to Greer and then throws out of bounds, overthrows the intended receiver, McMahon. Brings up a third down play. Calvillo waiting for instructions to find out what to do next.
As much scoring as the Aggies have done in this game, two of the last three times they've had the ball here in the third and fourth quarters, they've had to punt. Want to get out of that trend because BYU's coming on offensively.
Third and 10. He's got Mike Lee open. First down into Cougar territory at the 48-yard line, tackled by Christensen and DeMooney. And Mike Lee with a big first down reception keeps this drive alive.
Lee in the slot that time, inside of Alexander, went down and in, and Calvillo found him right there with a rifle pass right on the A into BYU territory.
Yards now passing for Calvillo. It's only his second game at 400 plus in his career. There's Profel Greer in motion to the bottom of your screen. Calvillo looking and just under throws Aubrey Thompson. Thompson was open.
Well, in the annals of BYU long passes, the 93-yarder that Walsh threw here a minute ago ranks right up there with this one, Detmer to Dredge of 97 yards back in 1991 against the Utes.
Well, they always seem to pull out the stops for the in-state rivals, don't they? Second down, 10 yards to go. Single setback is Dye. He's at the right side of the screen. And they give to Dye, and he's got a little bit of room himself. Mitchell trying to fight off a block, unable to do so, and Dye. Travis Hall and Jack DeMooney stopped on the play, but that was a nice run for another first down marker. That was Profel Greer, I'm sorry. I was telling Dye the whole time.
I thought BYU had stopped the play in the person of Shane Muirbrook, number 46. I don't know if we'll get a chance to see that, but Dye goes into the hole, and Muirbrook is right there. And so he stutter steps quickly to the outside and comes to this sideline and made a nice run out of it. There are his totals now. He's gone off with an injury, apparently.
Travis Hall providing some pressure and gets away to Dye, and that is Dye, and he gets down to about the 21-yard line. Profel Greer stepped out of the game. Dye back in. Patrick Mitchell knocks Dye out of bounds. As Travis Hall was coming in to provide some pressure, forcing Calvillo to throw the quick screen. Nice turnaround by Dye to make that reception. Ball's on the 21-yard line. Knocking on the door of the BYU red zone again. 7 minutes, 56 seconds left here in this game. James Dye again in the backfield. Calvillo back looking. Again finds Dye. This time gets about a yard or so.
Yeah, at least three people out in patterns. Each of them covered. Alexander was sliding along the line of scrimmage from the wide right wing, and so he went to the safety valve guy, and that's the running back out of the backfield, Dye, for not much of a game, really.
Frank Christensen there providing the punishment at the end. Take a look at James Dye. 155 pounds. Calvillo looking, he's got a man open. That's Aubrey Thompson. Touchdown, Utah State. Amazing. There's the Cannons. The Aggies are putting points on the board like it's going out of style here. They now have 50 up on the board.
That's that open trips formation. Three wide receivers to the right, the tight end to the left, and everybody was running vertically. Nothing across, no diagonals that I could see. Just straight down the field and get the ball down there. And Calvillo did it on the spot to Aubrey Thompson.
There's the extra point, which is up and good. Utah State again extending its streak of most points ever scored against BYU. We'll take a break. You see the Utah State band celebrating. Utah State 51, BYU 42. It's back to a 9-point lead. Back in a moment right after this. Utah State 51, BYU 42. Take a look at Aubrey Thompson's numbers on the day. Two touchdowns, 98 yards. He's got four touchdowns on the year. We see a kickoff and kind of muffed, it looks like. At the 36-yard line. I'm not sure if I understand what happened. That's number 96 who caught the ball. Number 96, Chad Lewis. But the kickoff, this was a short little pop-up to the second baseman, as we'd say in baseball.
Well, the Aggies have used that from time to time this year, sometimes with very good effectiveness. It basically negates any return, and you just got to get it further down the field. Not bad field position for BYU right here.
I want to call the infield fly rule on that. First and 10, ball's on the 37-yard line. John Walsh trying to lead his troops to the end zone. And there's Walsh, and he finds Christensen open, and he gets to the about the, well, he's still in bounds. He's still in bounds. Touchdown, BYU. Flirted with the sideline, but never quite crossed it. One play, bingo. BYU's back on the board with another touchdown.
I thought he was awfully close to the sideline. I guess not. Here's the pass, and I don't think we're going to get a very good shot of it right here. Well, in that picture, he's not that close, is he? Nope.
There we go. This is as close as he gets, and we don't quite see where his feet land there, but the official was running right there with him. You see the official behind, about 10 yards behind, watching.
Yeah, he never did step out of bounds.
Damon Smith was the closest to him. Well, I hope none of you fans at home have heart conditions, because this has been an amazing one. We're getting ready to put the 100th point on the board total for these two schools, as the score is now 51-49. BYU has made it a 2-point lead again. There's a band calling for some defense. BYU behind her.
So now another chance for Anthony Calvillo to get back on the field with the ball, and we've decided that he's thrown for 437 yards, and his previous best coming into this one was the 428 yards he had last year at Nevada in a classic game in which Nevada came back and won at the end with this kind of scoring today. So,
and along with that, we're seeing Calvillo in his finest hour here. Five touchdowns passing, one touchdown running. Six touchdowns on the day for Calvillo. He's had a busy one. The Cougar fight song in the background. One thing nice about playing an away game with an in-state rival, you get to bring everybody with you. 7 minutes, 31 seconds left in the game. With all this scoring, it sure is taking a long time for the game clock to tick away, and I think Utah State would like to see some of that, some more of that game clock tick away. James Dye standing at the goal line, ready to receive the kickoff from Joe Herrick and the Cougars. And Herrick tries an onside kick. There is a flag on the play. Looks like it might be a procedure call against the Cougars. But they just kicked it right past that 10-yard mark and had someone ready and waiting to receive it. But the official was on it instantly. He had that.
We have offsides on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty, re-kick.
Sometimes in the anxiety to get on that onside kick, they'll invade the neutral zone before the kicker gets to the ball, and I think that's what happened on this one.
Here you see Chad Lewis bringing the ball down, but unfortunately someone stepped across the line before they were supposed to. Cougars will re-kick it, this time at their 30-yard line. Dye moves up 5 yards, stands on his own 5. Take a look at the penalties. My goodness, 100 yards against Brigham Young. 10 penalties, 100 yards. That combined with the turnovers is what has allowed Utah State to mount the kind of attack that they have.
Well, this is the fifth weekend in a row they've had those kind of penalties, Carl. They had 160 against Air Force. They had 10 penalties for 98 against UCLA. They had 12 for 103 against Notre Dame. They had 14 for 142 last week.
My goodness. The mental mistakes. Dye takes it at his 5-yard line, works his way through traffic, and is met at about the 26-yard line where the Aggies will take over. Bobby Griffiths, BYU, made the stop. Looks like they're being spotted a little bit closer to the 27-yard line. First and 10. Time for Calvillo to work a little bit more of his magic. See Dye approaching the huddle. Seven minutes, 23 seconds left in the game. Tony Jenkins wide to the left side. They give up the middle for a gain of about 1 yard, maybe two.
Now we're getting to the point where you start looking more at the part of the scoreboard where the clock is running and not so much the points on the board. And the Aggies want to use that. They also want to do something about adding points, but they basically want to get out of here. They don't care if it's a two-point game or not. They want to get out of here with a victory.
We look ahead to possible field goal possibilities. Joe Herrick's longest of the year is 40. Cougars only down by 2. And there's the reverse to Mike Lee. Didn't fool everyone, but did get to about the 35-yard line, 2 yards shy of the first down.
On the reverse, the first guy to get there was Travis Hall, number 56. Watch this. Here's the handoff. There's Hall, kind of overran it. Lee kind of swipes him away, and he's off to a good run that began at the 28. He got out to 6 or 7 yards.
Finally, that was Greg Pitts. Put the final blow on Mike Lee to stop that run. Third down. 2 yards to go. Ball's on the 35-yard line. 3 wide outs to the right side. That's James Dye in motion to the left side. And he finds Aubrey Thompson complete for a first down and plenty more. And big Aubrey moves to midfield. Gets to the 40-yard line before he's stopped. Patrick Mitchell, Jack DeMooney in there for the Cougars to stop the bleeding on that play. Aggies move back into Cougar territory. First and 10 on the Cougar 40-yard line.
Tight end is over here. He sort of releases to the outside as they sent the motion man to get the defense spread out a little bit. The motion comes this way, and then Calvillo's going to find his tight end. There's the toss out that way as he released to the outside. And there's Aubrey Thompson dodging one linebacker, heading back toward the middle, and a nice gainer.
Continuing Aubrey's big day to give to Greer up the middle. Second effort puts it about 3 or 4 yard gain for James Dye. And the clock is ticking away. 5 minutes, 20 seconds left here in this game. Second down, 7 yards to go. Ball's on the 37. Second and 6, we'll say. The single setback is Coco Greer, as you see the clock at the bottom of your screen. And he's going up the middle and had him open, but just let him a little bit too much. Intended for Cody McMahon.
McMahon's the wide man to the right side, the far right side in the formation. Here he is taking off. There's Cook in coverage, and he cuts to the inside. So he's got the position, but the ball's not where he needs it. It's too far to the inside.
Brings up third down. Clock is stopped at 4:54. Kevin Alexander, Mike Lee, all to the left side. Profell Greer in the backfield.
Calvillo forced to flee, and he's got plenty of running room to the 20, all the way to the 8-yard line before he's knocked out of bounds. Calvillo again taking advantage of BYU coverage, and it looks like there could be an injury. There are trainers sprinting across the field.
Well, he lost his footing again on that blacktop there at the side of the stadium, and we can't see. He slid right into that area. We don't know.
He's behind an embankment there. Let's take a look at the play.
It's tough to see. This angle might show it to us. As the coverage was solid, he had to run. He's coming this way. A good gainer, obviously. And now, at the end of it, as he goes running out of bounds, he shoved out of bounds there, and he goes sliding on his rear end, and he's still down, and the trainers sprinted from the other sideline and got over there quickly.
They saw what happened immediately. Well, that's real close to the field of play there. That's only about 5 yards from what's considered inbounds. There's Calvillo. He is he's walking kind of gingerly. But he is up. And that is good news. Here's another look. This will give us a little bit of a better angle.
This from the end zone camera, and he probably scraped his arm or something on that slide on that tough surface.
Oh, goodness. Well, that'll bring in his quarterback, the backup, Dean Grossfeld, number 7. He's out of Cerritos, California. It was a junior college transfer from Cerritos Junior College, 6'2", 200 pounds. You take a look at Calvillo on the sidelines. Aggie fans want him back in the game. But for now, it's Grossfeld's call. First and goal at the 8-yard line. And the ball is fumbled, and Grossfeld just falls on it there at the 8-yard line. That's his first snap of the year, if I'm right.
Yeah, that's not surprising. A guy comes in cold like that. Those kind of technical things can happen. There's Calvillo talking to the offensive brain trust. He's coming back on. Limping a little bit, as you can see. He has to go off at least one play when there's an injury like that, and he's not in the best of shape right now.
Well, Cougar fans might remember Robbie Bosco. Similar heroics. Calvillo back to lead his crew now with the clock ticking away at 4 minutes 12 seconds left in the game. Utah State clinging to a 2-point lead. The give to James Dye up the middle, and he moves on up for about a gain of 4 or 5. Like the linesman is marking it at about the 2-yard line.
That time, Ernie Howren, who's normally a senior, a right guard from Concord, California, backing up Darren Mitchell, but he took Lenny Gomes right out of the play and allowed the gain that resulted in the ball being down about the 2-yard line. Now, this is the right guard here, Howren. There's the nose guard, Gomes, coming into it, and boy, that was a nice block by Howren taking Gomes, who's a good one, right out of the play.
Third and 2, Calvillo. Back, nowhere to go. He's going to go up the middle and try to score it himself, and he does. Touchdown, Anthony Calvillo. His second rushing touchdown of the day, his 7th, including his 5 passing touchdowns. An amazing play there right up the middle as he saw the gap and took it. Calvillo, I was just getting ready to talk about his mobility might be affected by the injury, and he just throws his body across the end zone. Give Utah State its 57th point on the day. Nate Morreale in here for the extra point. The kick is up, and it is good. Utah State 58, BYU 49. We've been flirting with this 9-point margin the entire second half. You hear the cannons in the background. 3 minutes, 20 seconds left in the game. Yep. 3 minutes, 20 seconds left here. We've got teams, as the Cougars are going to try to regroup. Take a look at the fans.
Well, again, I think one of the ironies of this game is that Calvillo, who's a fine runner, has made a living running the ball today in critical situations. Now, his passing totals are unbelievable. He's hit 31 of 58 passes now for 462 yards. But think of the times in this game he has dropped back and couldn't find anybody open. And again, the outstanding coverage by the Cougars is almost betraying them. There are his totals. 5 touchdown passes, a couple of touchdown runs. Those are national back of the week type numbers. And but again, the coverage has been good by the Cougars, and so Calvillo has taken off. 13 carries, 79 yards, a couple of touchdowns. I think it's ironical is what it is.
Approaching some records here today, I'm sure. Calvillo has set his own personal best. 7 touchdowns. 3 minutes, 20 seconds left in this game. And there's kind of a squib kick. Tyler Anderson will pick it up on his 11-yard line and try to work to the outside. Gets to about the 33 before he is hit out of bounds.
And Tyrone Trimble gave up his body on that one to make the stop. That was a crunching blow. Anderson had a good head of steam up, and then watch this. As Trimble comes flying toward the sideline, he cuts to the outside, gets past Haymore, but all of a sudden he disappears. And Trimble took out an official as well.
Ball's at the 32-yard line. BYU on their own 32. They have 3 minutes, 18 seconds left on the clock. John Walsh, first and 10. And he's got pressure, and he tries to unload, but is unable to do so. That's Danielle Taplin. Daniel Taplin came up from behind and stopped Walsh. Loss of about 1 yard on the play. Clock is still ticking at 3 minutes and counting.
Well, the receivers are covered pretty well, and they're just running straight down the field. And stepping up to try to find them, he was knocked down.
Matsuzaki at the top of your screen. Bryce Doman at the bottom of your screen. Walsh again looking, firing, and incomplete to Jamal Willis. He could not hang on to the ball. Third down, 11 yards to go. Crunch time for the Aggie defense.
Here's the snap out of the shotgun, and he fires it low. Tough one to catch anyway, and Willis couldn't get down there.
Hanging on to a 9-point lead, third down and 11, trying to stop this drive and get the ball back in the hands of Calvillo and company so they can eat it. Walsh up the middle and incomplete. Nowatzki was unable to come up with it. It looks like he trapped the ball. Had he been able to hang on to it, it would have been a first down. But Walsh underthrew the intended receiver, Tim Nowatzki.
Well, he's throwing everything low now for whatever reason, and those are tough to handle. Maybe that's the best against the coverage. I don't know, but they're tough to dig out of the ground.
Well, now the Cougars are in a precarious position, down by 9, 2 minutes, 35 seconds left in the game, 4th and 11, and they have to go for it. Aggie defense calling for noise. John Walsh out of the shotgun. The snap is low. Walsh fires up the middle and finds the receiver. The forward progress will carry him over into the first down yardage. That's Micah Matsuzaki.
Well, Charlie Weatherby's concern on this play is where the ball was spotted. He's off the sideline yelling. Here's the toss. The catch, and he's immediately wrapped up right there, Carlton. That's Travis Scow, but then there's a little bit of jostling, and where do they put the ball? They put it in first down territory.
First and 10, Cougars, 2:23 and counting left in this game. Walsh looking, firing deep, wide open is Christensen, who's popped hard by number 21, Michael Coe, but nonetheless puts him deep into Aggie territory. Now, Christensen is hurting. He's still down on the play. That was a touchdown-saving tackle by Michael Coe at about the 23-yard line.
There's again a shot from our end zone. Nice play, and what a crunching blow by Coe, who completely left his feet to deliver the hit. Steve Christensen does not have that smile on his face right now. He's hurting, and the trainers are out there to try to take care of him. You really worry when you see a guy go down like that and immediately grab his back. Here's another look at it as Walsh fires it. They hooked up nicely, and he goes down immediately, and the first thing he did after the play was completed, rolled over on his back and was grabbing at his lower spine. And that could be any kinds of things there. And again, we've seen enough of it on some of our telecasts. There he is right there that we know that extreme care has got to be taken in this situation.
There's a score, less than a minute remaining in Salt Lake City. San Diego State 41 over Utah 30. 8. Here's some cheers coming from our neighboring booth here. I think they might have even some updated information.
I think what they have is a bet on the game.
That's
what they have.
Somebody's getting dinner tonight. 2 minutes, 3 seconds left in our game. And the trainers are still down. Attending. There is Christensen, who is walking off on his own power, and that is refreshing to see. It's good to see. He looks a little woozy. Woozy for the wear, but it was a nice reception. It's put BYU in scoring position here. Minutes left in the game. The clock is ticking. John Walsh back to pass. Looking and finding Tim Nowatzki in the middle of the field. There's a flag thrown on the play. Nowatzki is unable to get to the first down marker. About a 9-yard gain. Two flags on the play. Ephraim Haymore providing coverage around Tim Nowatzki.
There's Nowatzki, number 42. He was the slot man inside of Matsuzaki. And he's the man that Walsh goes to here on a short route. Trimble coming over. He dodges Younger. And then the defensive backs, in this case Haymore, come up to make a stop.
And the penalty was against BYU. You heard the cheers of the Aggie faithful.
10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Boy, these penalty numbers after this game are going to be astronomical. But that's been the case lately for BYU. Here's a little bit of rush from outside. The wall steps inside of it. There's balls with some pressure. And the completion. But there must have been some holding in there somewhere, obviously, that we missed.
And there's the completion to Knowles. He gets to the 38-yard line before he's knocked down by Gary Brown, number 26. Have some more fresh news out of Salt Lake City with 9 seconds remaining. Utah has scored a touchdown to go ahead 45-41 over San Diego State.
Well, offensive football is in the air in this state.
Underwater. There is a flag flying high as Walsh throws it complete to number 42, Tim Nowatzki. But the linesman down here on our near side, he got more hang time on that flag than most punters get. Another penalty against BYU. A minute 12 seconds remaining in this game, and BYU is going backwards once they have had finally gotten into Aggie territory.
Illegal formation, only 6 men on the line against the offense, still second down.
You don't see that too often. Takes the Cougars back to their to the Aggie 42-yard line. They're facing a second down and 30 yards to go. Walsh back, has a little bit of room. He's going to pass it instead. He's got a man open, and look at a touchdown BYU. Amazing. A 43-yard touchdown pass to Micah Matsuzaki from John Walsh. 59 seconds remain in this game.
Now watch number 17 Haymore here. He's going to make a leaping jump at this thing as everybody's trying to position. It's over his fingertips. Matsuzaki's got it. Scow's got Matsuzaki, but it's too late. He's in the end zone.
Cole was just standing around looking for somebody to hit. Joe Herrick in for the extra point. I'm trying to make this a two-point ball game again. And he does so. And so we've got some exciting moments here awaiting us in the last 59 seconds of this game. 641 yards passing for John Walsh on this day. 2 points. Two-point lead Utah State has been hanging on to. It's been flirting, jumping back and forth between 2 points and 9 points. Seems like for about the last 4 hours. 114 points on the board total. That is amazing.
Starting to wonder when BYU and Utah State play their lone basketball game this year, they're not playing two, if Roger Reed and Larry Eustace can do as well as we've seen these two football teams today. That's true.
We're getting up into those kind of numbers, yeah. Points on the board. Well, we hear the Cougar fight song for what seems to be about the 24th time today as BYU celebrating another score, but Utah State's been able to hang on. They've come up with the plays when they've needed to. I'm sure we're going to get an onside kick here.
Yeah, we've got the Aggies lining up with all receivers along the front. Sean Turner and McMahon, Jenkins, and Lee, and also Michael Cole.
The good hands people. We ought to have Allstate sponsor this onside kick return. And there's the kick, and that's Mike Lee, and he's just going to fall on the ball, and Utah State will take over in Cougar territory at the 48-yard line with 56 seconds remaining in this game. Now, if you're looking at timeouts, BYU has two remaining. Utah State has all three of theirs remaining. Of course, they don't really want to stop the clock. Look at that play again. Mike Lee gets a beat on it right from the beginning. Sees the onslaught approaching, decides just to fall on the ball. Well, Calvillo approaches the line. They probably will need a first down out of this just to be able to elude all the timeouts that are coming. Profel Greer gets some running room, and he almost gets first down right there. He gets about 9 yards on that play.
That's the very thing the Aggies wanted to happen. They would have loved another yard, of course, to get another first down, but in the Nevada-Reno game earlier this year, the Aggies weren't as skillful as they wanted to be in getting that kind of first down in that situation and using the clock. Now, BYU's burned one of their timeouts right here.
42 seconds left in this game. BYU has one timeout remaining. And the Aggies go to the sidelines to discuss what they want to do. I'm sure that Charlie Weatherby has got to feel pretty good about a situation right now, especially if Greer is able to pull off just about one or two more runs like that last one. This will be an exciting win for Coach Weatherby if he can pull this off.
This is the seventh game Charlie Weatherby has coached at Utah State that has been what we'd call a close game. In this case, 2 points. The Aggies won the one game at the end of last year against Pacific, but they've lost the other five of the first six of close games. They're figuring it's their turn here, but they've got to control their own destiny right now.
And now it looks like Utah State's going to line up in that kind of protective. They'll just put the knee down and make BYU burn its last time out. You see Cody McMahon standing at midfield. Actually, he's just outside of the camera range there on your screen. He's standing at midfield. You see a shadow. And he's there to protect. Just in case something goes awry and the ball for some reason pops loose, he's the safety man. For some reason, the officials were holding the snap up. There we go. 42 seconds left. Second down, 1 yard to go. Calvillo will just put a knee down, and he does so. Immediately hands the ball to the official. And BYU immediately calls timeout. 38 seconds left in this game. Calvillo and company are beckoning to the fans, calling for some boys in this celebration.
BYU.
Now with third and three, they can put the knee down again. BYU cannot stop the clock. And if all goes well, as it should for Utah State, BYU will not get a chance to get their hands on the ball. 2-point lead, amazing. I don't know how many people came to this stadium today expecting to see what they got. See a 58-56 game.
Well, the last five times that BYU's had the ball, they have scored. They're just going to run out of another chance, it appears. Five straight scoring opportunities. They took advantage of every one of them, and they still don't leave.
38 seconds left. Now, we have at the coming up at the top of the hour, our friend in the sky, Mr. Satellite, is going to stop. So we're going to hang in here as long as we can. Hopefully it won't take that long to tick off the final 38 seconds of this game. This has been a long one. A kickoff at noon. And Calvillo, that's going to hurt his rushing numbers. I'm sure he's really upset about that, too. Ticking away, 29 seconds left.
And that'll be the last play of the game as the Logan crowd roars its approval as Utah State University shakes loose 10 years of frustration. The Romney Stadium goalposts as well with a stunning 58-56 upset win. It was a Wild West air show, one for the record books. For Craig Hislop, I'm Carlton Wing. Thanks for joining.